What's happening? Welcome to another episode of Talk to Me Johnnie Live, The Long Road. I am joined today with my good friend, Raphael Ruiz, world-renowned strength coach and uber ninja of things that we don't even know about. So, Raph, please introduce yourself and then we'll get rocking and rolling. And thanks for being on Talk to Me Johnnie Live.
Well, thank you for having me, Johnnie. I appreciate it. I always love coming out to this beautiful weather out here in California. Hate the traffic.
Well, nobody likes traffic. I mean, we were driving in today from picking up in Long Beach and we were stuck in traffic, you were like, I can't believe that it's bumper to bumper and there's eight lanes on the other side.
Who are middle of the day.
Yeah. Don't these people have jobs and homes? No. I think these people don't even have houses. I think they just drive the freeways all day.
I'm like, they can't all be performance coaches not scheduling sessions.
They're all personal trainers or actors. I think they're all actors just going to different, you know, like routines or events or auditions or whatnot. Or you
models.
Know, like, yeah, professional models. Oh, yeah. Jeez, the traffic's terrible. And I think when it's hot, it actually makes it worse. Because you're sitting in the car and you're like, you got the AC on, but it's still hot, and you're just packed in eight lanes. So
increases people's aggression. They get cranky, more road rage.
You know, I don't really see much road rage anymore.
What?
I think it's because I drive a big pickup truck.
What was the Michael Douglas movie where he just, in L.A., he just goes freaking nutcase?
Falling down. I just want to go home.
None of that?
So before we get into all the movie talk, can we do like an intro for Raph?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Just in case.
In case people don't know who Raphael is. So, Raph, please introduce yourself. Let's get a little CV so at least our audience can get up to speed. For those of you that don't know you, they should know you. And we'll just go if you don't.
Well, the good thing that they don't know me because I try to fly under the weather, under the radar. I am under the weather. I try to fly as low under the radar as possible. I started out as a strength conditioning coach, worked with the Bucks, then eventually got a job with the Rays, and then the Mutiny. So I kind of did my world tour of professional sports teams. That team contracted, and I got hired on as the strength conditioning coach for the University of Tampa.
Which is where we met.
Which is where you and I linked up.
Many, many years ago.
Couple years ago.
That was probably about 15 or 16 years ago.
Yeah, that was quite a bit. A lot has gone on since then. A couple of bad decisions, a couple of good decisions.
Well, you only have one bad decision. I've had... multiple.
All my hopes and dreams gone.
You sound like a parent. Oh, wait, you are. No, take it back a step further. So you grew up in Texas.
Grew up in Texas.
Kind of an Army brat. You guys, you know, grew up in Killeen and, ran in high school, ran track, played football.
Ran sprints, pole vaulted, everything from the 400 down, as well as played football, receiver, defensive back, punt return, all the special teams. Did that in college.
And you went to
Sam Houston State University in East Texas. And
where's Sam Houston?
Huntsville.
Where's Huntsville?
It's about 45 minutes west of Houston.
Oh.
So kind of in between East Texas and Central Texas, kind of right in the Piney Woods.
Nice.
Yeah. And that's about it. And then that took me to Tampa. As soon as I graduated, I hit the road.
How did you get to Tampa?
My internship that I had scheduled, because my goal coming out of college was to, my last 2 years at college, I actually stopped playing and I started to put more time into my physiology degree to further myself on that strength conditioning path. And so my strength conditioning coach did an awesome, Ben Pollard, hired me and said, you know, go ahead and start your resume building right here, right now. And I started doing the strength conditioning for those last 2 years before I graduated. And then my goal was to be a strength conditioning coach at the professional level. And I kind of looked at densely populated areas that had a high probability of you know, obviously, the more pro teams, the greater chance. So I did an internship at a local health club with the idea that I was going to pursue the Bucks.
Wasn't this
Harbor Island?
Harbor Island.
Harbor Island. That's right. And then I went and talked to Asanovich, and he said, come on, And that's kind of started my road there. But it was interesting because him, both Mark, he was really good friends with Kevin Harmon, who was the head guy over at the Rays. And he said, you know, we got a job opening. Do you know anybody? He said, we got this young whippersnapper who's either really enthusiastic or really stupid enough to take
a little bit of both.
A baseball strength conditioning job, which is...
baseball and strength conditioning, I mean, it's... I don't even know if those words fit in together.
Unless you played for Vern. Vern Gambetta was with the Chicago, I believe the White Sox, and he kind of pioneered functional training and definitely brought that to that culture within them.
So when you say the term functional training, like let's take a step back here. And this is kind of a pet peeve of mine. Like we were actually in the car talking about when we go down to Australia and some of these other countries, we've met a lot of sports scientists. And you know, everybody has these big sports institute deal and they're big into functional training or sports specific training, which I think is I'm always like, how can you do sports specific training in the weight room? I always thought sports specific training was what you did out on the field in preparation of your sport. So it's kind of like, you know, you're training Olympic swimmers and they're doing sports specific training in the weight room or out of the pool, and you're like, it doesn't work like that. So you got general, you got specific, and then when you think about functional training, I always think like, okay, what's functional training and what's unfunctional training?
Well, it's interesting because, you know, in our heyday, we happened to grow up in that area where
we pioneered that shit.
You did. Didn't you coin that term?
Uh-huh.
Functional training?
Well, I also invented the overhead squat, and nobody before me did a ring push-up.
Literally this morning, you also claimed you invented lifting weights. So you got that going for you.
I didn't invent lifting weights. I told you I invented... I invited strength training into CrossFit. Because there was an article that Tex forwarded me that this guy was like, you know, CrossFitters are strong because they do some form of strength training template before they do their conditioning. And I laughed because CrossFit football, that wasn't the norm. CrossFit, you know, they basically blended in and, CrossFit came in or CrossFit football launched. We used a periodized strength conditioning template with conditioning. So what I did is I invited strength training into the CrossFit and it virally infected a lot like the herpes that Tex got on spring break. Yeah, let me tell you about the second time I got herpes. And
But it's interesting because you and I grew up in an area where it was bar. It was big bar stuff. That's what you did. You pride yourself. You went to the weight room, you know, but after football practice and you put more weight on the bar than you could possibly lift and you bragged about your chest bumps. And then all of a sudden when we were around college age, Vern Gambit and those guys kind of started that, hey, let's do a little bit more functional, which in my professional opinion, his head is in the right spot, but if it's not coming from the source, it becomes bastardized.
Sure.
And all of a sudden, when I'm giving a presentation on sports-specific training, next thing I know, I've got a very enthusiastic coach or parent who has now tied a dumbbell to their 8-year-old child's tennis racket and saying, look, Raph, I'm sports-specific. And I'm like, no, that we need a timeout. Let's have a talk.
Our greatest experience with sports-specific training, and I have to go dig up the video, was the guy that forwarded me, and I know I remember I told you this, the guy that forwarded me the football helmet with the pad on top. And the guy sent me a video of the kids in the weight room with a football helmet with a pad on the top, and they were bringing the barbell down to the pad, and then they were dip and driving and doing push jerks, and then loading the bar, and the guy told me it was functional and it was sport specific because it was, you know, helping them prepare to take a blow. And I'm thinking about, like, there's nothing good with eccentric and concentric loading of the cervical spine for numerous reps in a weight room with a football head. I mean, and I emailed the guy back. I'm like, look up the term axial load. Do you know what axial load means? That's when you hit with your head down and you guys get paralyzed. You're basically axial loading these kids. And at that point, I realized we'd kind of gone down this road that we had to, like, go backwards and almost redefine this stuff. But, I mean, you got to think, like, when I first met Raph, I talked to my agent, and I was living down in Tampa. I just moved down there. I was a second-year player. And I hit up my agent, and I was like, hey, I need to train. And he's like, let me get you a name. He calls me back, and he gives me one name. There's this guy named Raph Ruiz. Here's his number. Call him. And this is like pre-texting. Like, there's no texting, so I call Raph on the phone. Really no, you know, emails. And I talk to Raph, and I go out, and I meet Raph at a the track stadium. And Raph has a set of hurdles, about 10 hurdles, some PVC, and rubber, and a TheraBand, and proceeded to break me the fuck off for about the next 2 hours with these. And I literally left, and I remember my agent called me. He's like, how was it? I'm like, we didn't lift any weights, but it was fucking terrible. And, but that was just, the introduction. You got to go out there and movement and all that, and really, really, progressed into something that was pretty amazing in terms of programming. And we ended up with a pretty good group of guys down there.
Oh, great. And, I look at that Lyman school that we had, and that was just brilliant, beautiful group of guys.
And then we had a weird deal where the weight room, remember, was the weight room getting under construction?
It was under construction.
And so they banished Raph and I to a warehouse.
Oh, the prison.
Yeah, it looked like a prison. So Raph's like, yeah, we don't have a weight room anymore. I'm like, we're going to train. He's like, they said we can put all the stuff in this warehouse. Now, mind you, we are in Tampa in the middle of the summer in a warehouse that's used to store art that the university doesn't use anymore. So big pallets of like boxes. And we're in there, and all we had was a pop shot basketball. We had like a full weight set, and then we had the gymnastics mat floor. And but nothing was bolted down. But we had some pretty epic training sessions, and we had probably 10 NFL guys showing up in training, and it was pretty terrible. Those are the good days.
Those were the good days. And I think the part that gets lost is, when you look at functional training, if it's not coming from the source of somebody who understands.
Well, define functional training. Like people use that term and kind of beat it to death. Like when I think of technically anything could be functional.
Absolutely.
If you need to have a stronger bicep, and because that's what's going to help you on your bench, then you do a curl, then technically a curl is a functional exercise. But usually when you hear people using it, they're usually using it in the terms of multi-jointed movements.
Well, yeah, absolutely. And I think that's the part what I was getting at is the bastardization is, and it follows along culture, is if one is good, two is great, four must be absolutely awesome. So you get these people where all of a sudden, let's work on balance. Okay, that sounds like it's feasible. Most athletes should work on that. So I'm going to one-upmanship you, and I'm going to go single leg barbell squat on a stability ball, because if you're working balance, I'm really going to work balance, and mine is much more functional than yours.
It's the Mark Verstegen approach.
The Mark
Verstegen. Little athlete's performance.
So, and it becomes interesting where, for me, it's figuring out what your vulnerabilities are. If somebody's lack of ability to hold good posture is a deficiency in their upper back. So for me, functional training would be, let me get somebody to do more horizontal pulls. But if they are limited on their horizontal pulls because of poor rotator cuff stability, then functional training becomes Job's exercises.
Sure.
So let me do some Job's exercises. Now all of a sudden I've got a strong cuff that can handle more load. Now I can do more ring rows or more pull-ups or whatever. Now I have a bigger, stronger back, and now I can put a bigger, heavier bar on my back. And now all of a sudden I can take that load and turn it into a heavier clean or a heavier yada, yada, yada. Now I have more neurological energy that I can turn into something exact and specific onto the field.
Oh, I think the one thing that's really unique about you is you've trained athletes from just about every discipline. Most of the time when you meet strength coaches, like I train football guys, I train this. I mean, we talked to Ed Costner yesterday, who's trains some of the All Blacks players with
awesome.
The Franks brothers, and he's a basketball strength coach, old time powerlifter, and pretty interesting to hear into powerlifting and went into basketball and kind of got into these different things. I mean, you started as a football guy, track guy, and then worked with football players. You trained all those baseball players when we were down in Tampa, and then worked with soccer, because I remember we worked with those soccer guys, and then went out and obviously worked with swimming was what the next one you worked with. I mean, you've really worked with a lot of different disciplines. Now, based on all those different disciplines, are there threads that, you know, like a common thread that you can say, well, you know what, everybody's an athlete, everybody needs some, you know, level of athleticism and strength, so if I attack it from that perspective, everybody will get better.
Well, it's interesting, and you bring up a good point, is I struggled when I was a developing strength conditioning coach, when sports specific became very popular, that became a very big phrase where everybody's like, it's gotta be sports specific. And my heyday in development hit a high speed ramp when I started to, as a strength conditioning coach, when all of a sudden I have a football background in track, which, as you know, that's a blessing in disguise, because I mean, that's the gold standard in terms of, if I can help somebody run faster as a strength coach, you're helping 99% of your athletes.
Well, is there a difference between being a strength coach, strength conditioning coach, and a speed coach?
I don't think there should be, but I think that's a personal thing, depending on the person's philosophy.
Gotcha.
That's a huge philosophical approach, because some people, if you're a hit guy, you're not touching speed.
Yeah.
If you're a speed coach, then you're trying to get everything to almost be sports specific, which can still play into a lot of problems down the road in terms of the absolute development of strength.
Some of my favorite things is like seeing like, Tyson Gay and Gatlin and those guys actually talking about what they do for their strength training, and it's kind of an abomination.
Mm-hmm.
Like I, whenever I see those guys ever talk about, hey, this is how we squat, this is what we do, this is their training programs, I look at their training programs and almost think, I wonder if these dudes are fast in spite of their training, or whether or not I don't understand enough about it, because what they're doing doesn't look like
absolutely
being that beneficial.
Well, I think having enough opportunity with high-level athletes, I've learned that sometimes the best strength and conditioning coach, the best performance coach, knows when to just not do harm. You know, I worked with Dion, and I'll be the first person to tell you I didn't help him run a 4-2-1. My job was just to help him extend his career as long as possible. Just don't cause any major catastrophe, and hopefully help him get a little bit more flexible, help him increase a little bit more stability along the way, because he wasn't lacking in any area.
Well, you know, the one thing Dion was ever not lacking in is he never wanted to hit anybody. And my claim to fame, if you know this, was we were playing the Dallas Cowboys, and I came running to the pile, and I saw Dion's little skinny, like, pencil-neck ass running to the ball, like, kind of jogging in, and I peel back and dive over the pile and knock him down.
That might, you?
Me? And I remember I was like, it was like one of those things where I wanted to get up and be like, you know, this is for everybody that always hated prime time. All the shit-talking and everything, and I remember my brother was like, it's the best Christmas present you could ever give me was hitting Dion.
Who was your coach that did the highlight of you guys just late-shotting people?
That was Juan.
That was awesome. That was a highlight video of just spearing folks.
They probably can't even show that anymore.
No.
I remember he all our late hits around the pile, all these great things. He like went through and skinned the whole season and had that highlight reel. And I remember we're like watching it, and like there was probably $250,000 in fines.
Oh my God.
In that video. And I remember watching it and being like, this is great. I was like, can we get a copy? He's like, no. This will somehow get out. We don't want people to know that.
Oh, that would be like our fire-up video for the UT athletes. I'd be like, guys, get around the TV and watch this.
We had a lot of good hits.
Oh.
Yeah, those are the good days. Well, you know, I mean, and then they really cracked down on that shit. So, I mean, like, you know, there was a weird deal where, like, all of a sudden, 2003, 2002, you know, we could do that, and then all of a sudden, like, I got fined in the preseason.
Ooh.
And you were like, ooh, that was a $750 game. You're slapping with a $5,000 fine.
Ooh.
I was like, this is going to be an expensive season. I better fucking slow my roll.
Wow.
So.
Yeah. And that's... And it's across the board with football.
Yeah, well, I mean, so...
Now, did it start with you guys, or was it more safeties, corners coming up and crushing folks?
No, I mean, they really got pissed about us chasing people down and cleaning up dudes around the pile, because we were just taking, you know, great shots. And
because you guys are big scud missiles crushing folks.
Yeah. And you know what? Like, the NFL had an image problem, too. You know, they had the whole deal with, you know, they knew that guys were getting hurt, and they knew that, you know, the last thing they wanted to do was... have a guy like Deion Sanders who's getting paid, you know, tens of millions of dollars a year, get lit up by some dipshit left guard from the Philadelphia Eagles along the bottom. That's fucking bad for business. I don't want that shit. You know, like Jerry Jones is up there being like, what the fuck? You know? But like, that's like that type of shit, because if you ever watch like a receiver, and they really fixed it now, like mm-hmm. a receiver gets tackled and he doesn't go down, and dudes used to come in and clean shit up. You know, like now they can't clean things up the way they used to.
Yeah.
I mean, before they used to hold the dude up and try to get everybody in there and then
you know, get the ball out.
Yeah, and they come in and bust him up. Now it's like if you come in there and you bring the dude down or you hit him in the back, I mean, they're going to find you. I mean, they, like, I'm really glad. I don't know if I'm happy or sad based on
I was going to ask that.
But, you know, because we had that conversation recently where I played at the end of an era where there were guys that were, you know, like what I call the real football era. Where
Cecil.
Yeah. Dude, Chuck Cecil and, you know, Timmy Houck and John Lynch and those guys, I mean, who, you know, really played the game like it should be. They ran downhill, put their head in there, and they hit. But, you know, now all of a sudden you look at it, and here we are, you know, geez, a decade plus later, and, you know, our fullback, you know, Kevin Turner, ends up with ALS and ends up passing away recently. And I remember coming in, and that guy would level people.
Yeah.
You know, and then, you know, seeing those big hits and then seeing the problems that he had a decade later, you know, you got to believe that there's some correlation. And then you got all the, you know, teams and no, there's no correlation. You're like, right.
Well, it's interesting because that's from a player's view. And we, as the people who have never been on an NFL field, you know, we're crying about the pacification of America. But when who's the all-pro tight end that is just completely, I saw an interview with him, and he is from the older generation, Mackey.
Oh yeah, John Mackey.
And you look at that and think, wow, you know, as my son, as your son, and you're like, you want to prepare them, you want to make sure that they get the benefits that we learn from football of combat.
Yeah, but,
and
but so like people ask me this question, and so I'm like, I don't claim to, let me see how I put this, because I don't want to sound stupid as usual and just talk out my ass, but I like to believe I'm kind of an anomaly in a lot of ways. Like my dad didn't play football. You know, my dad, you know, worked and was an attorney and has been a practicing attorney for over 50 years. I mean, you know, my dad. And I remember, I mean, we joked, dude, like when I first told my dad I wanted to lift weights, he's like, why do you want to lift weights? It's stupid. It's counting to 10 over and over again. That'll never get you anywhere. And I remember being like, oh, but dad, I want to lift weights. And he's like, that's stupid. I'm not spending, you know, any money on a gym membership. So my mom ended up not telling my dad and going down and getting me a gym membership, 24-hour fitness. And so like that type of stuff where like, you know, my older brothers both played college football, but they played Division III. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden I come along and then like, you know, how does a middle class white kid from, you know, the peninsula, Palos Verdes, Torrance area all of a sudden get a chance to go play football and then go get to play? So I really think about, you know, and also if you look back, and I remember Troy Vincent a couple of years ago said in the last 20 years, less than 15,000 guys played in the NFL and less than 1,000 played longer than 3 or 4 years.
Yeah.
And so like, you know, in terms of like the bigger scheme, it's such a small, small percentage that when people ask me that question, I'm like, would you let your son play? I'll be like, yeah. I mean, everything good I learned in the world, I learned from my parents to play football.
Absolutely.
You know, I learned how to play on a team. I learned how to work with other people.
Accountability.
I learned how to persevere when it was hard.
Right. Grit.
Know, yeah, you learn everything. You learn about training and gives you focus. And I think people need that structure, you know, and whether it's, you know, martial arts or it's football or something to train for. I think you have to train for something combative. You have to do something physical that tests your mettle. You know, just getting up and throwing a ball or hitting a ball or playing a game, you know, that doesn't invoke some form of like physical combat, I think is a mistake.
You know, it's interesting. Our good friend Luke Pettigrew, mm-hmm. We were breaking down during one of our seminars about from the lineman school, and we said, let's build somebody who would be successful as a lineman. And everybody had these contributions of they should have good wingspan, they should have certain size, good feet, blah blah blah. And he paid you the best compliment, and he said the one thing that separates good from really good linemen is John is just nasty. He's got a mean streak. And everybody looked around and nobody had mentioned that. Everybody was like dimensions and anthropometric measurements. And he says to play at the NFL for as long as he plays, you've got to be nasty. You've got to have something in your head that says, oh, hell no.
Well, it's, people talk about like anger and getting pissed off. I never got mad. I always had almost like the serial killer deal where like when I would get pissed, I get real calm and I kind of like start kind of giggling a little and I'm like, oh, we're going to hurt these people. Or like, you see, like you do something. I remember, I was playing right tackle and really nice kid, Juan Castillo. Not Juan. It's, his last name's Castillo. He played D tackle for San Diego. I can see his face. I can't remember his first name. And played at Northwestern. Super nice kid. He had a messed up elbow. So his right elbow was messed up. He's playing over me in the five. All of a sudden he takes his hard inside move and I cut him off and he tried to give me like this hump. And when he humped, I lifted my arm and he went to hit me and I knew he wasn't going to move me. And all I did was I locked him down and like arm barred him and he straightened his arm. And then I started sprinting towards the end zone with him. And I literally was running as fast as I could, like jumping back. And he's like, arm in this like elbow thing. And I like tried to like literally like leap and like tumble, this like so stupid. And like he's like, dude, I'm like, and then we were friends. He's like, why would you do that? I'm like, I don't know. It just seemed like the thing to do. And it was nothing I could ever really stomach or like really. It was nothing in conscious thought. But all of a sudden, you put somebody in a stressful situation like that. And all of a sudden, I got real calm. Like, I never, like, the guys, like, I played with, like, Kyle Turley, and Kyle would be going absolutely fucking ballistic and yelling and screaming. And he'd be like, why aren't you more mad? I'm like, I just get really relaxed and feel really focused and, like, really calm in these stressful situations. So I didn't necessarily know if it was a nasty deal, because I always think nasty guys like this. I just had a cool, calm, collected, like, level of, like, composure where I just wanted to go out and hurt some motherfuckers. And I that to me. And the other thing too is I always bend my knees, so I always played lower than other people. Mm-hmm. And I remember like people being like, "Man, how do you get that much bend?" I'm like, "I'm not as big as you fucking guys. I gotta play lower."
Leverage.
So, leverage. Leverage is the key. And I think if you can play with leverage and you have the ability, because I mean, think about it, dude. Like think about why people get killed in battle. Like, this is something I always think about. Having played for a long time and practiced and seen guys come and go, I mean, like a revolving door, the one thing that I noticed about all the guys that played for a really, really long time that were all really good is that they never got stressed out. Everything went according to plan. You got beat on one play, no problem. Or, you can't worry about it. You don't get pissed. You just keep moving forward. And I asked one of our good friends we were talking about earlier, with his job in terms of working in the military and, special forces operations. He said the guys that, all of a sudden the bolts are fine, the guys that get real calm are the guys you want to be around. Yeah. The guys that get real nervous and get jittery and do something stupid don't end up there that long. So maybe the same deal.
Get a little too excited?
Yeah. So, I mean, I always joke people like, oh, you were a mean, nasty player. I'm like, no, I was just calm, calculating, and extremely fucking cruel. And I wanted to hurt some people. But, I mean, I also took that Tyson approach. I mean, growing up as a boxing fan, I mean, I looked at playing football a lot like, Mike Tyson.
Yeah.
I'm going to throw big punches, and I'm going to wear you fucking out early. And hopefully I can knock you out early where you don't want to play.
It's a lost art. Like, you watch guys nowadays.
It's a lot of patty cake.
Yeah. Like, nobody really digs into the body like Tyson used to.
Well, I mean, football or fighting or boxing?
Boxing.
Oh, 100%. We could talk boxing all day. That's the reason why they're, heavyweight boxing is dead.
Yeah.
No one wants to watch Klitschko Brothers.
That's terrible.
It's terrible. A little piece of me dies.
Yeah.
And because, I mean, I'm used to, like the heavyweights I can think of are the guys that were, like, big, strong, like, nasty. Mm-hmm. The head's going to fall when I break the body, that
Absolutely.
Type of stuff. You watch Tyson come in. But that was also, I mean, like, I don't know if it was good or bad, but I would play tight on people, and you know that. I used to play up on dudes. And a lot of guys always wanted to play with their heads back and their arms. I played nose to nose, And I was, and my idea was that I'm going to put my hands in you, I'm going to hurt you, and then you got to try to out-athlete me. And in my 3 feet or three-yard deal, you're not going to beat me.
No.
And, you know, and then also I had pretty good hands so I could hold like a motherfucker. Let's let you know a secret. I held every play. And I didn't get called that much.
That is what they say. That's what they say. Every play.
Every play. So what you do is you look at the chest as like a steering wheel and you go, you know.
Turn the wheel.
3 and 6. Right on. Or I'm sorry, 3 and 9. And you just lock them on. Thumbs up. And then at that point you just...
What's interesting, and that's one of the things that I've noticed with a lot of high-level athletes, is that killer instinct. You know, we're at a wonderful time during the Olympics of watching two of the greatest swimmers ever in Michael Phelps and Katie Ledecky. And when you listen to her working with the national team and how she trains, where she outright explicitly says, if you're going to beat me, you're going to die trying. I'm going to go out so hard, so fast.
I get goosebumps because I think of the Prefontaine.
Yeah.
Where it's like.
That's how she does it.
Yeah. It's like, dude, you know.
You're going to die.
Yeah. If you're going to die. And you know what? Today's a good day to die because it's going to take a suicide pace.
And you watch her basically sprint a 200 and then she just carries that same speed and that same environment into a race that's double that. And so if you even expect to be able to beat her in a 400, I mean, you really have to say, I might die today.
Yeah.
And you even have though, to be willing to do it. Even though it's a swim race, you're like, I'm going to have to die. I might drown today trying to beat her.
But, I mean, think about, we saw Phelps. All of a sudden, he comes out, and he fucking beats those dudes. And he's literally looking at these dudes talking shit.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I mean, unbelievable. Like, that backstroke deal, and, like, you know, they lose. I mean, dude, he was up in these dudes. I mean, when have you ever seen swimmers... like take that level of aggression and be like, you know what, I'm not only am I the best swimmer in the world, I'm going to prove to you I'm the best.
Oh yeah. You
I
know,
mean,
I
what does
I,
Michael Johnson still have to prove? I mean, Michael Phelps, like, what does he still have to prove?
Nothing. Now. Not after this Olympics.
No, but I mean, think about it. He didn't have to prove anything coming into this one. He's still the best in the world.
You're
and
right.
The dude's coming in like he's like a underdog and nobody's expecting him to do well. And the dude takes the same approach.
Well, I think it's interesting where you have high-level athletes, and we're talking high level. And I think that's the difference that the average person needs to understand. It's like, yeah, you might have been good in high school. You might even been an NCAA champion in college. But just like playing in the NFL, just like the Olympics, just like any high-achieving, there is a tiny, tiny bit of people in the world that can be the tip of the spear where, you know, Tex and I were talking at the U.S. Olympic trials, you know, the finals, there's the top 8 and then they only take 3 of those,
yeah.
And, you know, and then you will race, you know, basically the top of that. And then out of all of those rounds, there's going to be 1 gold medalist. Like you are the cream of the crop. And
isn't that how it should be?
Oh yeah.
Like,
oh, yeah.
Like that's the reason that you get up in the morning and you go to play those stupid fucking preseason games.
Oh, yeah.
So you get to the regular season, so you get to the postseason, so you can win, you can be the final dude. And I think, like, for everybody, you know, football, we got a lot of bites at the apple. And you get a lot, I mean, not many as baseball and some of the other sports, so I mean, it was more meaningful. But what about the Olympics?
4 years.
Where you got 4 years. Your whole, like, what if they peak, like, in year two and you're, like, the best you are is at the national championship or the world championship? Like, I was watching the Simone Biles, and she's won, like, the world championship, like, 4 years in a row, and she's, like, 19.
Right.
And you're thinking to yourself, well, wait a minute, aren't those girls at 19? Aren't they technically outside their peak?
Yeah.
Don't they usually peak at, like, 15 or 16 years old? And can she do it? And then she comes back and smashes it.
We had a Camille Adams at the Olympic trials this year get DQ'd for a turn. You know, the judges said she did an illegal turn, and they DQ'd her, they kicked her out, which, you know, being part of her journey was heartbreaking because it was like 4 years, and all of a sudden she got, they said, sorry, Camille, you're DQ'd. And
what was the term?
I don't remember what it is. I mean, I'm not a swim coach.
Is there terms that are there?
Yeah. You know, there's certain things about hand placement, you know, coming off, blah, blah, blah. But they filed for a review, and they overturned it. So once they looked at the tape, she had, I think it was one hand was on the wall, they thought, and she actually did touch two. So then they brought her back. But for that one moment, it came to fruition, like 4 years have just gone away. Like, okay, well, good luck.
And the one thing that, too, that pisses me off a lot is, I hate the coverage of the Olympics because they only want to show the Americans.
Yeah, it's bad.
And they're like, Bob Costas is like, hey, we're cutting to this. And you're like, Bob, like, fuck off. I hate Bob Costas. I want to punch him in his face. And
wasn't he the one that had the pink eye last Olympics?
I don't know, dude. He's the worst.
He did.
And even though America, like, for some reason, I'm like, everybody's like, oh, Bob, I'm like, fuck him. He's the worst. And you know what? Part of the problem becomes all we ever do, you know, they figure the American attention span is so short that we can't show everything. We got to show in clips. Tex and I were just in Spain, and they had the European track championships on. Mm-hmm. And it was on primetime, and that was all that was on. And we sat at the bar from what? Like 5 to 8 or 9 o'clock, like at least 4 or 5 hours, drinking beers, watching it. And they literally showed everything. I mean, it was unbelievable. And I was like, how come they don't do this in America?
Well, you didn't see why?
And you know the one thing they didn't have on there?
What?
They didn't have Bob Costas.
Or commercials.
Yeah. But here it's like...
I'll tell you why. NBC said that the majority of people watching the Olympics are females. This is from their statement. There's more females that watch the Olympics than men. And from their studies, women are more interested in stories about...
Oh, yeah.
Relational stories, tying in the family, so on and so forth, versus men just show me. Just, I want to watch the race, blah, 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 move on.
That's actually very true, because...
So that's why. And that's what they do with the NFL.
That's why people like the Hard Knocks and a lot of these other things, which, you know, I was on Hard Knocks, and we kept calling it Hard Cocks. And as a result, they cut a majority of my... involvement in it because they were like, you can't say hard cocks. I'm like, oh, I'm sorry. So it's hard cocks. And then they mic'd me up and all I did was just curse. I don't want to be involved in that shit. Because it was bullshit. What they were doing is they were going in and they're trying to find these storylines and they would fabricate storylines. And then when we watch it, we're like, that doesn't fucking happen. And so that's bullshit. But it's kind of frustrating. I mean, but for me, all I want to see is I want to see the competition. I want to see the best in the world compete. And
even if it's not the first person.
No. Right. And you know what? I like to watch the non-Americans compete too.
You're right. Because I think that's what the Olympics are about.
Yeah.
Show me the best. Show me the best that the world has to offer, even if it's not American.
And the Australian hurdler, the 110 hurdler girl. What's her name? Begins with a J.
Jenicky.
Yeah, she's by far my favorite athlete on the planet.
She's
right
adorable.
Now. Yeah, she's awesome. You know why? Because she's not only a phenomenal competitor, but she actually has fun, and she's a pretty girl who is actually, like form follows function.
Correct.
So she's actually my favorite Olympian right now.
Did you watch the Olympic lifting?
Yeah.
Did you watch was it Kazakhstan? The guy that took that big, he was basically, he could have settled for silver, but he could have went he went well above his PR to try to take the gold from the Chinese guy, and the guy nailed it.
Oh, wow. I didn't see that one.
He literally was like, they said, you know, his second attempt, they said, what are you going to do? And he was like, put the weight on there. And he shot his world record and his PR up by like 14 kilos. It was a ridiculous amount of weight.
The German guy did that a couple years ago. You remember the big super heavyweight?
Yes, that's right.
His wife passed away. And then he ends up, you know, PRing by 13 kilos or something. But, no, I mean, we Tebow it, and then I've been trying to watch it, but all my daughters want to watch is gymnastics. So we've been watching the same gymnastics over, like, I was like, don't worry, we're going to get to the other stuff. And then we had a phenomenal amount of women's synchronized diving.
Yes.
There was like 2 hours of synchronized diving, and I'm thinking to myself, Bob, like, this is like...
I'm not against...
I think it's amazing, but I just don't want to watch that much synchronized diving.
Same as me. Same as me. I'll watch anything, but when there's 2 hours of kayaking, and I'm like, kayaking is cool, and I've done it, but I don't want to watch 2 hours of kayaking.
Which, I know we were talking about the rugby sevens, so I watched the sevens. I watched Fiji yesterday, and I
How did the U.S. do? I didn't see.
I don't even know. I mean, I'm sure somebody will chime in here any second, but so I got to watch Fiji win, and the thing that was interesting is the sevens is obviously a much faster paced game. But to me, it looks like 7-on-7. It's like passing league. Whereas, like, I want to see the full game. I want to see the scrum. I want to see the battle of the fight. So I'm kind of surprised that maybe they were just going to see, like, test the sevens and maybe they bring in rugby. I'd love to see rugby in there. I realize because football will never be in the Olympics, and it probably should never be in the Olympics.
What sports are they adding this for? I saw surfing. Surfing is going to be in the Olympics.
Surfing.
And there's another
pole vault. Pole vault. They're going to pole vault in the Olympics.
No, they're not. That's stupid.
So our joke is Raph's a pole, but was a pole vaulter. And I firmly believe that the best athletes on the planet are pole vaulters. Think about this. You have to be fast like a sprinter. You got to have the accuracy to be able to put that long-ass fiberglass pole in a hole. Like, talk about marksmanship run. And then you have to lean back and hold on as that thing shoots you.
Yeah.
What is it, like 20 feet in the air?
Yeah.
And then you have to somehow actuate your body over it and then not break your neck.
Like, a lot
to
of
me,
times.
That is, I mean, so when Tex and I were in Spain, we were watching the European Championship, we got to watch all the pole vaulting, and we were like, holy shit. Like,
that's beautiful. It's beautiful to watch when the guys know what they're doing, when they're good at it.
Yeah.
Yeah, as opposed to jump and pray kind of Ruiz technique.
Was that you?
Oh, my God.
The suicide squirrel. As you just went,
I made it.
As you're over there, like, doing a cannonball, you're like,
Well, that was my thing because I had good speed and I was strong, which ideally the poles are graded according to flex and bend. And so.
So you were using the pole like a 126 pound woman?
I was actually trying to get up on a very strong pole because I knew I could just jam that thing in there and then just let it throw me wherever it threw me because I weighed so
little.
Sounds
like Texas dating. like his dating philosophy. Just jam it in there and let it get thrown around.
On that note.
Da-da-da.
All right, so I'll just go ahead with a little question we have here.
Lay it on me.
Let's see. John, you talk a lot about Raph on podcasts and his influence on CrossFit football and your programming and stuff. Where can we see Raph's influence in Field Strong, Jack Street, or Grindstone?
Raph's influence is in everything. So, I really owe a debt of gratitude to Raphael for, training me and being my roommate for a number of years. When I thought I knew a lot, coming from Berkeley, Berkeley grads, tend to be a little full of themselves, and I get in the NFL and, come in and start and I get hurt and I rehab back and then I train and start 16 games and I figure I know some shit. And then I meet this guy over here named Raphael and we start training and completely reshaped what I knew about strength conditioning and gave me a different opportunity to see some things and also allowed me to do some things that I never thought I would be able to do. And, and really seeing, you guys have heard me steal this line from Kung Fu and other places in Sansu, which is, when the master's ready or the student's ready, the master appears. Dude, I was ready and just at a stroke of luck, I meet Raphael. I mean, literally my agent, I called my agent, he's somebody to train with, and he gave me Raph's number. I don't even know how he got Raph's number. He doesn't even know how he got Raph's number. Because I asked him, I was like, how the fuck did you get Raphael's number? He's like, I don't know. It just appeared. And you know what? And I thought about that. I'm like, it's great. And so, the one thing that, Raph really gave me was this idea of foundations and this idea of, like, you got to lay your groundwork. And I remember when we would come in, as soon as the off season would start, we'd get back right around Valentine's Day. And like, dude, we didn't touch a barbell. It was all stupid Job exercises and this and, creating stability and the boards and being able to really kind of fix what's broken and, fix any injuries, address. And then it was like this ramp up. And then it was like, hey, we're going to do this. And like, we would build a base, everybody gets strong, we do this and then get more dynamic. And then finally we would like change a direction in sprinting. And then we didn't really start conditioning until we were about 6 weeks out from training camp.
Yeah, into the summer.
And we did so much speed work. So I think we were really seeing a big influence, especially right now in Field Strong, is with a lot of the sprint prep and a lot of the movement things that we're doing. And then, the day that Raph and I were racing, and I almost beat him, it was
the big angry bear was catching me.
So like we're running hundreds with, you know, Bill Stolten, God rest his soul. And Bill thought he was pretty quick, and dude, we rolled out, and Raph, of course, would like sprint out and like trying to look all cool and smoke us. And all of a sudden, dude, he was like either not letting up, or I found an extra gear, and I was fucking motoring. And all of a sudden, I see Raph running, and he like looks over his shoulder and is like, puts his head down, and we were literally fucking barreling, and I almost took him. I like firmly believe if I had another 2 yards, I could have won. And Raph was like, okay, that's good. And that was it. That's all we ran. He didn't want to give me another run at it.
We only have two scheduled today.
He's like, oh yeah, we're only going for two sprints today. That was perfect. We didn't want everybody to overlap. So, no, I mean, where you really see Raph's influence is a lot in the field strong. The Jack Street stuff is, that just comes from just a lot of shit. Like, that's just a lot of the bodybuilding stuff that I did. Like, when I moved back to California, I trained with these two bodybuilders, a guy named Cesar Martinez and another guy, Brian. And these dudes were big, strong bodybuilders, and they were training hard. And what you see in the Jack Street is a lot of what we did. And, you know, and then, you know, there was some good influence from John Meadows. I really got the idea of pre-exhaustion from him. You know, the idea of hitting a bunch of stuff before you hit the heavy movements. And then Grindstone is... actually just was based on the program that I wrote for Bill Baratsky. You know, the idea of, you know, how do you create a strength program that kind of has hierarchy? And, you know, hey, if you got one day to train, this is day two, day three, day four, and you kind of hit the hierarchy. So I'd say you see a lot of Raph and Fieldstrong. So that's it.
I think a lot had to do with the... It's the approach that the coach takes towards developing the athlete. And me, in my head, I was always wrapped around fixing vulnerabilities, fixing weaknesses, because I always knew, you know, it just made a lot of sense to me. If somebody had a bad ankle, let's not worry about all of these big movements until we fix the dysfunction that's going on in his ankle. If somebody's got a bum shoulder, then who really cares how much they can pull or bench, because that weak link, that loose bolt is going to fail this athlete at some point in time.
Sure.
And so that was always my prime was, hey, let's create some sustainability, let's create some durability and make sure these athletes can withstand it. And for me, it never made sense to take that next step, or at least not concurrently weaving in the ability to take that next step until you said, hey, you know, I'm comfortable signing off on this person. Because some of the protocols, and you only get this through experience, where little things that are hidden in the workout have come from us making a crap ton of mistakes.
Sure.
And it's like, hey, I know that down the road, if I don't do this, then we can't do accentuated negative pull-ups, because if your shoulder girdle isn't going to withstand, if you are not going to be able to hold your humerus in its socket, then I can't give you this. And we know that there's a crap ton of benefit of doing accentuated negative work. So let's go ahead and spend some time and give you the opportunity to be successful within that arena.
But let's get into negative stuff. I mean, this is one of those things, especially like as a strength coach, I really diverge into, and I'm like, I really believe, I mean, we used a ton of accentuated negatives, whether it be the man resistance with weights and different ways to load it. We did it with barbells, and we did a huge training block, as I remember, with accentuated negatives. But the problem becomes is, how do you write programming, or how do you offer that to people that you don't see? And so like I kind of really run into this kind of like dichotomy of like this, literally this polarizing battle of being like, I know that, you know, if we could do some accentuated negatives, it would work. But then at the end of the day, you know, unless you see somebody train every day, there has to be this efficacy of like, I don't need to fuck people up. And we talked about at the beginning, you know, you made the point, you're like, you know, when you work with really good athletes, the goal is not to hurt them. Mm-hmm. And I think like when you start looking at programming and you're helping people remotely, like we do on so many occasions, you have to write programming that is going to make them better, but also not hurt them. Cool. Even though, you know, you look at risk versus reward, that, you know, hey, I want you to put 105% of your 1RM back squat on, and I want you to do a 3-centric eccentric load.
Right.
And, you don't have, I don't know, bumper plates, or you don't have pins to set it on. So then I want you, as you get to the bottom, I want you to shoot it backwards. I mean, like that's, you know, I was reading Cal Dietz's book, Triphasic, which is pretty funny because he goes through and he actually in the book, I think he made the claim that he invented concentric, eccentric, and isometric training. So yeah, but I mean, in his book, he kind of makes some weird claims like that, and I was kind of like, shit, we've been doing. He was talking about, you know, doing accentuated negatives with heavy weight to like a box, for example, just sitting on a box, mm-hmm. which is a safe way to do it, assuming you have two or three spotters.
Correct.
Because anybody that knows, you can't spot somebody from the back at a box because the box is in the fucking way. And so, like, I'm looking, I'm like reading his book, and I'm like, yeah, you know, accentuated negatives, you know, you're dramatically stretching the muscle and, you know, doing these things, but, like, what's the efficacy and the safety of these programs?
Right.
And, like, that's where we run into a lot of, I guess, you know, kind of wiggle room with people is, like, you know, how do you really blend between, you know, what might be the best training practice and what is safe? And I think for your system, and I firmly believe that nobody on earth does it better than you, is the idea of addressing and assessing weaknesses, shoring up those weaknesses so you can do more advanced training. And I remember, you know, years ago when I remember I came back, I think it was like the second year or third year we'd worked together in the off season. I asked you, I was like, hey, what about all that shit we did a couple years ago? And you were like, what about it? And like, how am I going to do that? And you were like, you don't need it anymore.
I don't need it.
Yeah, you were like, why am I going to have you do a bunch of stuff? Like, you know, the training progresses, you progress. We don't have to go back and fix that stuff. We already fixed it.
Yeah.
And then I realized that it was a dynamic program in a lot of ways.
Well, as far as addressing it, I think there's a number of ways you can do it. Perfect world scenario is, yeah, let's just have everybody come here into this facility and we'll just line them up and train them all. You have to sell the programming with the understanding that they have to buy into exactly what you're trying to sell. And the hardest part for me, working with 6-year-olds to Olympians, is the coaching doesn't change. Like, I'm pulling proverbial hair out trying to get some of my Olympians to do some things that my 6-year-olds do easily, or vice versa. And it doesn't change. It's instead of either I have to do it myself and I have to take my entire Olympic team and do manual resistance on everybody myself, or I have to get them to buy into what I'm trying to teach them. So if I can get them from a theme standpoint of saying, protect your streamline position, because you are going to live and die by the efficiency that you will produce in the water. So as you're doing this exercise, your partner that's pushing down on your leg is trying to take your streamline away from you. Sure. Then that makes sense for them. But if they don't buy into that, then the quality of that work is zero. And it's just like you said, it's better not doing anything at all than go stand over there and do a band, which you could still do. We do a lot of offsite, so when the guys, like I didn't do a lot of the training camps with them, so instead of, if on their workout card it said manual resistance abduction, and they weren't there, or their partner wasn't there, it's put a band on, step, kick your leg out, and then try to hold it. So by manipulating certain variables in body position,
which is not nearly as effective.
Nowhere near as effective.
Which we know. Because
but it's still, it's like,
it's better than nothing.
I'll take the best that I can get.
Well, I mean, the one thing I find hard too is, I mean, you worked with all, you know, the Olympic swimmers and the guys down in Rio. How hard was it to get buy-in, which seems amazing? Like, I always think, like, you know, and as a professional athlete, like, strength coaches would come in, and like I was always amazed. Like, I'd listen to what people say and say, sounds great, let me do that, but I also want to do my stuff too, until you show me that your stuff is better than my stuff. And also, you know, you look at guys that are probably, you know, maybe football's a little bit different because we come from a strength conditioning background, but it's something like swimming where there really isn't a definitive strength conditioning program, or really it's not like football where you're going to bench, you're going to squat, you're going to lift, you're going to do power cleans, you're going to do this strength program that's specific and has been tried and true and proven in swimming.
But that's what they want.
They want a football program.
They do.
Why?
Because one of the things that they found – In 2010, USA Swimming brought me in, namely David Marsh, brought me in and said, we need a better performance program for swimmers. And I said, well, let's start with this. And we brought out the pen and pad. And I said, what are you looking for in your swimmers? It was really interesting because if you remember, at 2008 was the heyday of the high-speed suits. Oh, remember those where the shark skin and those things were blowing records out of the water?
Didn't they? Like we got to get rid of these things.
Oh, my God. Like, it's ridiculous.
Like they were smashing things.
Oh, yeah. Speedo was coming up with, like, meteorite line suits, and they were just ridiculous. You know, they weren't even in the water. They would dive off the blocks and float, you know, kind of thing. And there was already talk that those things were going to have to get curved. Yeah. And so, being a visionary, David said, these things are going to get banned.
Yeah.
And it's really going
to... Well, you have to be really visionary. Like, I remember watching that Olympics and being like, there's no fucking way that all of a sudden, like, they would have, like, the number three guy beating the world record time.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, what I'm saying is visionary in that these are going to go away.
Oh, so we need to find...
And it was in particular for women, because the conversation was you can take a non-athletic person in terms of their build and their body type and just stuff them into one of these suits. And next thing you know, they are just flying.
Sure.
But now if these suits are gone, now all of a sudden what we need is better athletes.
Sure.
I need athletes that could dive off the blocks but still have the ability to get into an efficiency position.
Sure.
And that's what they were missing was, for the longest time, you either swam well and let's try to add power. Let's try to get you to jump better and things like that. And it was failing miserably. But that's where you saw the advent of better athletes started to swim better. Now you see a Cullen Jones, who is a phenomenal athlete. And if you ever watch his videos of him diving off the blocks where it's like guys are here and then here's Cullen.
Yeah.
And it's like, wow, now all of a sudden we're getting superior athleticism and these guys are just starting to fly.
Well, I mean, isn't it true that all things being equal in terms of athleticism, the stronger athlete would be the better athlete?
As long as it force versus form drag. And so the thing that swimming forces you to remember as a performance coach is producing force is great, but if it causes too much drag, then not so great. So as you're swimming through the water, all of a sudden, if the way that you move your body causes you to sink your hips, then no bueno, like a Tex. So in that instance, hips drop.
Well, he has a very unique swim style. Isn't it called the rock?
It's the like drowning rock.
My overdeveloped glutes.
The overdeveloped glutes. So basically, kind of like this, water.
Did you stuff Tex into like a sausage suit? Like you put him this. I'm just imagining Tex like in this like.
Stuff him in.
In this like unitard with like a head thing on. He's like, Raph, I'm ready. You're like, all right, we're stuffing you in that bitch. And you're out there.
No, my ass blew out, so we had to go to the backup plan.
Ah.
We just went with the buttless chaps.
So you just cut the butt cheeks out, and it's a little more drag.
Yeah.
I'm surprised he didn't try to shave you like a hairless cat.
We tried to, but he broke a couple of razors. The electric one just...
Too coarse.
He's got a weed whacker.
Oh, shit.
To get back to that, it's interesting that the greatest buy-in is no different across the board, and you'll recognize this, is most people are ready to learn, and it goes on what you were saying, is most people are ready to learn when they either are injured or they're underachieving.
Yeah.
And so I had a lot of buy-in from athletes that were either injured or they weren't performing as well as the tier one guys. And so it became, hey, Raph, what do I need to do to be able to swim as fast as blah, blah, blah. And so we started to introduce our concepts to the swimming world where we're connecting shoulders and hips and shoulders and hips through planes of motion and getting the athlete to produce power but also have enough movement vocabulary to get into an efficient position. And that's the one thing that land-based animals don't have to do.
Yeah.
You know, a football player, track athlete, never has to get into that pooping dog position.
Yeah.
But the pooping dog position is what you want your spine to look like as you're pushing through the water. So it's that careful mix of having enough of vocabulary to be able to be.
So what you're saying is that actually the efficient movements for swimming are almost opposite of the ones that we would think for a land-based athlete.
Absolutely. Well, I wouldn't say opposite. I would say the right tool at the right moment.
Gotcha.
So diving off the blocks, you better look like Michael Jordan diving off, jumping off, you know, for a dunk. But the moment you're in the water doing your butterfly, you better get into that pooping dog, hips tucked underneath you position, and go ahead and pull that rib cage down versus the broad, bold, hip sinking position.
So. Was it, you know, you being fairly, you know, as you guys can tell, very analytical, I mean, was it something where you were like, show me tape?
Absolutely.
You know, like, because I'm sure that they
loved it.
You know, like the bottom of the pool, and you know,
loved
the sides
it.
And
the orca.
Yeah, so you got a chance to really see, like, you know, end zone sideline type stuff in the water, and you probably looked at it and thought, huh, that's the movement. All right, well then we have to figure out how to make those guys efficient and strong in that movement.
It really boiled down to the same approach that we took with every other sport is, Coach Wellborn, tell me what your athletes can't do. What are you having trouble teaching your linemen to do?
Sure.
What are you teaching your basketball players to do that they don't have the ability to do? So leverage, for instance, okay, I wish my athletes would get lower and I do everything I can. I do those cages and I try to get them to do pass bro through the cages and they're standing straight up and they're hitting their head and their knees are straight as an arrow, but they're just bending over. They can't do it because you haven't given them the movement vocabulary to do it. You didn't give them the flexibility. You didn't give them the patterning. And so it's the same exact principle as going to David and Coach Bob of saying, why can't swimmer X swim faster? Well, you know, on his butterfly, he can't get his arms up. Why can't he get his arms up? Okay, so then we would start to evaluate that. We'll look at the film. Is one arm working harder than the other? Is he symmetrically rolling? Is how does his kick look?
That this approach, being as methodical as it is, like, let's figure out where their limiting factors are. Like, let's establish what they're doing in the water and the sport in which we're training them, and then work backwards and try to design training programs that allow them to get better. That seems like a
logical,
non-crazy person form of training.
Absolutely.
Opposed from here's standard strength conditioning, and even, you know, that everybody's used for land-based animals, and now we're going to try to adapt it over for water-based animals, which has a set of movement patterns that's different. It seems to me that crazy people.
Well, it's interesting because we're pioneered when we look at the best of the best, and that's where we will always fail as performance coaches, as specific sport coaches, because we look at Michael and we say, that's how we're supposed to do it. We look at Carl Lewis, that's how we're, and you can't.
Well, that's the age old Michael Johnson 90-90.
Absolutely.
And I've heard sprint coaches, you know, talk about the 90-90, and you're like, dude, he had the perfect anthropometrical ratios,
yep.
and you know, to be able to run 90-90. And, you know, we've seen that forever. I mean, you look at the best in the world, and my favorite is actually watching Michael Phelps when he's literally walking out there and he takes off his coat and you're like, this is the most awkward looking dude on the planet. His chest and back are like this wide. He's like razor thin, skinny arms. His head, mm-hmm. I mean, the dude's like feet are what, like size 17.
And
he's got like these crazy short legs, massive hands. It's almost like they went through and were like, okay, how can we best the world's best swimmer? And they actually designed it. My wife and I had this great conversation yesterday with, do you believe that, and I think we were talking about Katie Ledecky, mm-hmm. You know, we were seeing like the effort and the passion and literally like her fire to compete is pretty, you know, when you hear her talk, she's kind of bubbly, but you know, dude, she's a fucking savage.
Oh my God.
And
she is an assassin.
My wife made a funny point. She said, you know, do you think that people find a passion for the sport and pour it in, or you have a natural aptitude and you're good at it, which allows you to develop a passion?
Both.
And I told my wife, I was like, I didn't really ever have a passion to play football. I just wanted to fucking hurt people. And
that's the avenue to do it.
Yeah, and you know, and I used to joke, dude, I'd go to jail for what we did on the football field.
Yeah.
And you know, it wasn't about the game of football, because people would ask me all the time, what's that? I'm like, I don't even know what that rule is. So I mean, there were things I didn't know about football in terms of rules and things. Things would happen. I'd be like, fuck, I gotta learn that one. But what I knew is that here's this dude 3 feet from me, and we're gonna have a one-on-one fist fight for the next 3 hours, and I want to win more than I lose. Yeah. And you know, and so we were kind of talking about it and being like, I think the best in the world have an aptitude that makes them the best, and then they couple that with, you know, a fire. And I really believe kids, especially, and people in general, like what they're good at.
Absolutely.
You know, like if I'm good at something, I like it. It's kind of like the age old, like I tell these guys all the time, just like whoever likes you. That's like the classic dating line. Like all these people are like, oh, the girl didn't like me. I'm like, well, you're dating the wrong person. Find the girl who likes you and then like her back. Isn't that what I tell you, Luke?
Yeah, and my mom's earliest advice, like my first heartbreak, was you need to end up with someone who loves you more than you love them.
Oh.
Interesting.
My brother.
Hopefully, Packy isn't watching this, because that might be the strategy.
My brother told me a long time ago, just like whoever likes you, you get really, really far in this world. And I remember being like, that makes a lot of sense. And then you realize people be like, she didn't like you that much. But I mean, that's kind of the same deal with sport. Like, if you know, like, if all of a sudden I didn't have an aptitude to play football, it wouldn't have been like, oh, my life is over because I can't play football. I'd have been like, oh, I'll find something else to do.
Have you ever seen the workouts for the Bolt does?
Yeah, watch his training stuff.
They're terrible. And so,
are you talking about his weightlifting workouts? Yeah, no, it's fucking terrible.
So that's a perfect example. Is the fastest man in the world, we should all be lifting like that.
Have you seen him do Olympic lifting?
I have. Power cleans? The reverse curl. The power reverse curl, it's nice.
It's actually a reverse hip thrust to backy
little
roll.
Undulation thing.
Yeah. Well, I mean, what about, I think it was, I can't remember if it was Tyson Gay or if it was Gatlin, but one of those guys was talking about, you know, I'm going to show you guys how to squat, and he had a YouTube video, and he was doing like, fucking, basically just like unlocking his knees. And he was talking about the new squat. You ain't got to go down anymore. And like people were frying him. And I was like, I always go back to Charlie Francis talking about Ben Johnson doing a, you know, triple for 600 off the box, box squat. That was below parallel like, 7 or 8 days before he set the world record. And everybody's like, oh, he tested positive. I'm like,
but still.
Yeah, so did Carl Lewis, and nobody fucking brought that up. But yeah, and then we were laughing today about how there's all these different people that have tested positive and got ostracized, and then like 4 years later, their time is disintegrated. And you're like, wait a minute, if he was the best and he was taking drugs, what's up with this guy? Like, what were we talking about, the Kenyan girl that ran the 10,000 meters?
In the 10,000 today, she obliterated a record that stood for 20 years.
Basically, Leonidas didn't run that fast.
By a girl that admitted she was on drugs. And so the other girl that broke the record before her shattered that record that had stood for a long time. So this is like a 50-year-old record that has been broken. But her record that she made today is off the charts. So by smashing the admitted drug users, and now her splits, she negatively split, which is very difficult to do in track, run the second half faster than the first. Her second 5,000 meters was faster than the world record 5,000 meter open, and then which was god awful fast. But the first 5,000, which was slower, would still have medaled in three of the last five Olympics. And came out of nowhere.
Yeah.
First Olympics.
One hit wonder?
It's a lot. No, for me, those are red flags.
Oh, you think red flag?
I'm not accusing her.
I just believe in the biggest performances reach the biggest stages.
I agree.
You know, I like to believe in the inherent goodness of people, and I think that people go out there and they do their best. And, you know, I mean, but I'll tell you this, if there were two Olympics and they were both on at the same time, one was drug testing, one wasn't, which one would you watch?
I would definitely watch both.
Yes, exactly.
I'd
have them on
both.
Split screen. Yes. And I would hopefully they'd be like, oh, that guy just threw the shot 400 feet. And she just ran, you know, I mean, like, you know, at the end of the day, I mean, it's, people want to watch the best in the world.
Absolutely.
Doing the best. Putting up the big, you know, and, you know, like, I realize that you're saying that, like, you know, female viewers want to read the stories. Like, I don't need to see the backstory, like for me especially. Like, I want to see the the victory in their eyes. You can see it in their faces, and you can see people doing the best in the world. Yeah. Like to me, that's all. Like, I don't need the 3-minute lead in where they're talking about how this with the parents. I mean, the Simone Biles thing was I got to say, it was great about how, you know, her grandparents adopted her and raised her. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, like, I could read about that. Like, I want to watch that girl put one foot in the ground and, like, go up, which looks like 12 feet in the air, and do, like, 7 twips and land and keep running. And I'm thinking to myself, there's no way.
You know what my favorite is? When in the Olympics are rampant about it, how many times have you seen, and they've done a special on this drawing on the wall of a little kid and saying, look, Johnnie wanted to be in the Olympics ever since he's 4, and now his dream has come true. And in my head, do you know how many kids have drawn that picture? How many broken dreams and shattered hearts?
So last night we watched the Olympics, and my daughters went and put on their leotards.
Adorable.
And so they were there practicing their gymnastics as they were watching. They're 4 years old. And, like, they go to gymnastics, and, like, they literally had their leotards on and were practicing their movements.
Awesome.
As they're watching the Olympics.
Awesome.
And, like, I literally came in, and I saw them, and they were literally working on their tumbling, working on their cartwheels, working on all their stuff. And, like, my favorite is, regardless of whatever the other one's doing, the other one's trying to coach her to do it better.
That's adorable.
So, like, Jill will be like, no, let me show you. I can do it like this. The life of twins is constantly trying to one-up the other.
That's
one.
That's awesome.
And so I take them to gymnastics most days, but on Tuesdays we go. And
but you got to encourage that.
I don't have to encourage their fucking competition, dude. It's already ridiculous. Like, I'm wearing more bracelets than you. No way, you can't count. But we go to gymnastics, and Killian, my one daughter, she's really, like, such a gifted athlete already. And she gets everything, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, within like 2 times, Jamie all of a sudden started mastering things that she couldn't. And all of a sudden, she's like, I got this. And Killy's like, tears, and comes over to me, and she's like, Jamie's being mean to me. I was like, you talk trash to her every day in the car. And she's like, but she's getting better than me. I'm like, you just got to train harder. Sure enough, what do? We're at home, and she's trying to do push-ups.
Awesome.
Well, she can bang out 10. We brought in my nephew and his buddies. That we're doing like a little sprint thing. They're 10 years old, and I was like, hey, I want you guys to break out some push-ups. And how many push-ups did they do?
I won't even count.
Yeah, like, we couldn't even count one decent push-up. Killy gets down and bangs out like 10, and she's 4 years old, chest to the ground. I'm like, this has got to feel pretty
awesome.
Bad when your 4-year-old cousin is doing better push-ups better than you. But like, that's the, you know, the competition of the whole thing. But yeah, just like, I agree with you. Like, there's, you know, going to be, everybody's got that picture, I'm sure, every one of those little girls, but how many people?
Especially now with it, watching the Olympics. Every kid right now is drawing.
Yeah, I'm going to win this. Yeah, my daughters were like, I want to be in there. I'm like, well,
you know what's interesting as a coach, and as you prep for long cycles, so now that we're at a school that starts at pre-K all the way through 18 years old.
Do you really call, like, this is what I call the mastermind. So, finally, somebody's giving you your dream.
Unbelievable.
So Raph, as you know, he took a job back in Tampa as a strength conditioning coach at a private high school that, how old are the kids?
Starts as early as pre-K.
So pre-K up through high school.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a very, very well-funded place to bring in Raphael to be the mastermind of athletic performance. I remember you called me, you're like, oh, this is the greatest. I'm like, you still don't even know what they're fucking into. You're over there, like, with charts and diagrams, being like, well, based off of this. But, I mean, you got to think, like, being able to offer that level to, you know.
Yeah.
You know?
Well, it's interesting because off of a 70 roster, say, swim team, we had a couple kids that did really well, and they went to junior nationals. And this one kid hasn't been swimming very long, and he's younger. He's 12, 13 years old. And got a good head, really, really driven, and he ends up doing well at the meets, and the coach's instruction was to take 2 weeks off, like, don't want to see you in the pool, go be a kid, blah, blah, blah. Takes half a day off, shows up, he's like, I watched the Olympics, shows up at 5:30 in the morning to my weight session. I was like, what are you doing here? You're not supposed to be here. And he's like, I can't. I got to be here. And in my head, I'm thinking, you know, you can't pay for that magic right there. Because that's the kid that has a great opportunity to become.
Isn't that
really,
what
really
the Olympics is about, though?
Absolutely.
I mean,
inspire people.
Yeah, it's about inspiration and, like, the idea, like, at least for me, I like live and die with the athletes.
Yeah.
Like, I see the you know, the victory successes, like, as they're running, like, you kind of live this journey with them, and you know, and then you think about the inspiration. Now, surprisingly, what was, and maybe because we didn't really watch it that much, but I, as a kid, I kind of remember, like, I remember we watched the Olympics and, like, never, but maybe the TV's better now.
It is.
Maybe there's a lot better. I remember it came on and it was, like, not nearly as gripping as I see it now. And I think, God, like, maybe, well, and also our TV sucked. Nice. Now I see it on, like, 70 inches where, like, you know, like, it's, like, life size and the kids are like, oh, this is great. I'm like, dude.
Maybe the lead-up stories are hooking you in.
I just want to watch people kick ass. Like, that's it.
Well, think about this.
That's it.
Simone just won the 100 free, first African-American female, which now look at potentially what she could start. Because, you know, to go back to our earlier question was, when the representatives from swimming said, what... and I asked them, what are you looking for? And they said, better athletes. And I said, okay, describe your swimmers to
me. Big bitch.
And they were like, we want strong, thin hips. Strong, thin legs, wide shoulders, strong upper body, long wingspans. And in my head, I'm thinking, that is every playground in America. I go, you haven't tapped in nowhere near enough to enough basketball players across the country.
Sure.
And I said, that's your market. I go, I mean, there's a kid sitting on a bench somewhere, you know, on his middle school, high school team that's got, you know, he's 6 foot with a 7 foot wingspan. I go, that kid needs to be in the pool.
Well, I mean, that's what Travis Mash did. Travis is one of our buddies, his strength coach. He has a really, really dominant Olympic lifting team. Mm-hmm. And he started going out and trying to just recruit football players and kids awesome. That were good football players to come in an Olympic lift. And now he's got all these kids that are, like, you know, junior national, high level, and he built an entire team of these kids.
It's awesome.
And I asked him, like, where do you find them? He's like, honestly, they're all, like, the kids that, like, were either a little too small or, like, just were a step and, like, were strong and did all these things that couldn't play football. And he's
tweeners.
Like, yeah. He's like, dude, I'm pulling them in and making them all Olympic lifters. And these kids are crushing it. I mean, like, you know, I watch his stuff on Instagram and, like, you know, kind of follow him a bunch. And I'm always like, fuck, these kids are killing it. And I remember we were on the podcast. He's like, dude, there's a bunch of ex-football players. You know, and I always joked, like, you know, I watched guys in my weight room in the NFL do shit on a daily basis where I'd be like, dude, you realize that what you just did there, you probably set the American record or, like, did some really, you know, there's some super strong guys. I mean, guys that didn't really train and can still bench 600 pounds, which is a phenomenal raw bench press for guys to train every day.
Absolutely.
So
this actually is a kind of parallels a question we have.
Cool.
And it's basically, you know, do you guys think that the threat of CTE and concussions could affect the future of football? And an interesting kind of side point is, like, we've heard people pulling their kids out due to the threat or even because of concussion symptoms. And then since that's potentially is happening, could it open up possibilities in the sport of weightlifting and rugby?
Sure. I think Raph hit me up. He saw the concussion movie and was like, you know, what do you think about it? And I haven't seen the movie. I don't know if you guys know, but I actually auditioned. They hit me up and I auditioned for that.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. So, and when I went to the audition, I had, like, really mixed feelings about it. And I was like, I don't really want to be here. And it was, you know, because they are portraying the guys, and I don't know how they're portraying because I won't see the movie, but I did read the book, League of Denial. And I remember you asked me, you were like, you know, would you let your son play? And I thought I wasn't ever going to have to answer that question because I had twin daughters, and then I ended up having a son here not too long ago. And the only analogy I can really think of is one of my favorite movies is The Hunted with Tommy Lee Jones and Benicio Del Toro. I don't know if you guys ever seen it.
Filipino Kali?
Yeah. Yeah, I know you've seen it. And in the movie, Tommy Lee Jones is talking about, you know, and he's kind of a socially awkward kind of, you know, recluse. And the FBI lady asked him, she's like, you know, how did you get into this? How'd it go? He goes, well, you know, my dad went to Vietnam and he either lost sons, I can't remember exactly what it is, but he came home and he was going to make sure that his sons never died in another war. So at that point, he put a training program, he put this whole lifestyle together where he was going to train them survivor skills, and if they ever had to go to war, he was going to train them to come home alive. And I remember when somebody asked me this question, that like that scene in that movie went through, and it's based off of Dan Brown, who's a tracker, and he teaches stuff in New Jersey and all over. And if you guys could look him up, I've read all of his books. And that same idea that if you are going to potentially have a son who might want to play football, it is your responsibility to train him in such a way that he can survive the rigors and demands of that deal. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I always looked at my buddy Rick used to joke, and he'd be like, man, you shouldn't call that weightlifting. You should call it like building a meat suit. And I used to joke, and he'd always call it, be like, dude, your meat suit's looking big. Looking thick. He always made that joke. He's like, dude, it's almost as if the weight training creates armor. And that armor and position and all these other things end up helping you survive the rigors of the game. You know, and I think about, you know, people ask me, like, oh, did you have any back injuries? I'm like, not that I'm aware of. But, like, we worked a lot on trunk stability. We worked a lot on that idea, but I also got a lot of that from the fighting stuff where, you know, you are never in a point of completely relaxed, but you're never tense. You know, and I remember watching guys get hit in the jaw, and it was the dudes that were, like, in this position all the time, or the guys that kept their mouth open were loose. You had to keep that task-specific tension. And I think teaching that and also, you know, weightlifting, training, moving, doing all those other things and making sure that you're always on the receiving end. The guys that got hurt playing football were the guys that were on the receiving end. The guys that were on the giving end, and my analogy, dude, and I've told you guys this before, and I literally said this in the NFL in a interview with somebody asked me one time, what's your philosophy with football? I was like, I need to be the hammer more than I'm the nail. And if I'm the hammer more than I'm the nail, I will survive this game and I'll walk away. If I'm the nail, I won't walk away, they'll wheel me away. And I always think, like, you know, on a long enough timeline,
right,
everybody's going to get fucked up. So as long as you're the hammer more. So I think if I have an opportunity and my son wants to do it, I have to prepare him the best to my knowledge, and then all of a sudden push him out there. But not also, you know, give him the opportunity to do it too young. I mean, most of the guys that I know that have gone on to play very well in football have found it later in life and done other things. You know, and I think you develop and you look at the skills that you want to create, you create those skills, and then, you know, football's just a melting pot of a lot of cool other sports and skills, and then just some fucking grit.
Well, I think the two things, the takeaway that I got out of that was, right now in the NFL, there's the movement that is leaning towards rugby, changing the way that they tackle, you know, less of a head contact, which is interesting because when you watch the videos, it's completely opposite of what we were taught. Like, put your head on the backside, don't put it on the front.
I was taught, take your forehead.
Oh, yeah.
And I want you to, like,
drive it
through, but I want you to hit in a position that's actually 3 feet behind it. So, I mean, like, it was the idea of, like, I want you to hit through the body.
Yeah.
Like there was no hitting the body, and that's why when you watch the old football stuff,
guys. Ronnie Lott. Love that guy.
Dude, well, like, I always think the hardest hit I've ever seen was Timmy Houck, the guy, and he's the safeties coach now for the Eagles. Mm-hmm. But Timmy was Chuck Cecil's protege and was his roommate in Green Bay, and then after they got rid of Chuck Cecil, they didn't want his ass around anymore. But Timmy came to Philly, and I swear to God, dude, he was like Timmy the Hammer, dude. I mean, it was unbelievable. He ended Michael Irvin's career.
Yeah.
Michael Irvin caught the ball, and Timmy literally fucking lit him up. The dude's out there paralyzed, and what do the Philly fans do? They cheered. Such a kid.
Remember when one of the hardest hits I remember was Steve Atwater hitting Christian Okoye into a hole. Yeah.
Dude, to this day, they could hear it in the top, like the top section. And didn't Okoye go down?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I remember that was when they buckled him.
Think about the physics.
Yeah, Okoye was 260.
260 is a well-moving giant man.
They tried to say he was 220. That dude was ever been at like 260.
No, that guy was 260.
Yeah.
And I remember Steve putting him on his butt. And I was like, the physics of that are unbelievable. That would have killed anybody else. I'm glad it was Christian getting hit. Yeah. Anybody else touching that ball would have probably
And he was never the same.
No.
No, he was a Nigerian nightmare. And then, after that, no one. Well, don't you remember my other, on the other end of the spectrum, which you guys probably don't know, was the whole Bo versus Boss.
Oh, yeah.
Where it was Bo Jackson versus Bosworth.
Oh, yeah.
And Boss got annihilated. And that was the end of his career.
Yeah.
Like, he...
ruined him.
Yeah, he, if I can... But to this day, Bo Jackson is, I think, if you could go and make a case for the best, most gifted athlete ever to play,
yeah,
I think Bo Jackson's up there.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
I mean, there. I was pretty fortunate. I when I was in eighth grade, Art Shell was the head coach of the Raiders, and his son Chris Shell was my friend, and I got to go to some of the Raiders games. And we were actually standing on the sideline. I can't remember who it was, but I remember they were on the far side, on the far hash, and they ran like a little toss play. And I remember watching Bo Jackson run and literally put his foot in the ground. He literally ran right at the sideline. And we saw him coming at us. He put his foot in the ground and like made a right and literally ran and like beat everybody. Like
turn the corner on everybody.
But I mean, like, normally like people turn the corner. He like ran, like planted and went back this way. And I remember thinking like, and I was a little kid. I mean, like, you know, what was I, like 12 years old? And I think like, oh my God, that's the fastest human being I've ever seen.
Huge.
And it was big. It was massive.
Huge.
I mean, big legs, big everything.
I could definitely have made a pretty good Olympic run.
But I mean, don't you really think as a parent, and like, you know, like you have, you know, Raider and Keely and Jamie are all about the same age. Like, you made a point on the podcast recently that you're like, you know, I'm trying to raise him in such a way that I instill in him with what I'm going to instill past the next generation.
Absolutely.
You know, I'm trying to be the best grandfather in a lot of ways. And I really, that was a really deep way of looking at it. And as I thought about it more, you know, as a parent, your job is to arm your child with all of the skills they need to be successful in the world.
Right.
Like, I have to not only, you know, teach them to be physically active, but I have to teach them to read and to color and this. And then teach them some basic, you know, social skills and manners.
And how, like, to deal with people. Yeah. How to deal, yeah, absolutely.
Like the manners ones is, like, a hard one. Like, somebody comes in and says hello and they don't say anything, and I'm like, don't be those kids. Don't be those, you know, like look people in the eye, absolutely. Like, you know, like this. Like, and I think, you know, having a son and having daughters is pretty interesting, and you can realize, I think, people treat their sons and daughters very differently. They treat the idea of, like, I need to raise my son to be a man, and then, you know, I have to take care and protect my daughters. And I told my wife, I'm like, I'm not doing that. So, like, with my girls all the time, it's a big thing, like, you know, look people in the eye, what do you want, like, the, you know, and it's like, the age old, like, oh, my daughter has me wrapped around my finger, and my dad told me that. I was like, really, that's funny, because, my daughters are wrapped around my foot in their ass. And he's like, what do you mean? I'm like, dude, they don't get away with anything. I don't subscribe to that bullshit.
Right.
You know, this idea that, you know, because she's your girl, she's going to get away with more. I was like, dude, there's no way.
Right.
I was like, I'm on these girls. And that to me is like, at least the way I look at parenting is, I can't fail these kids. And, you know, and the same thing too with athletes. And you write programming or you bring people in. And part of the reason why I don't own a CrossFit gym anymore was that was one of the things where, and I've told these guys a million times, I knew I couldn't own a CrossFit gym anymore when I wanted it more than the people wanted it for themselves. And like, that's a hard realization. And I wonder as a parent if you'll ever get to the point where you're like, I know this is important, I want this for you, but I can't get it through your head that you, that this is what you need. And then I guess at some point you just gotta,
well, I think, you know, the hard part for
the problem is you can't sell your kids.
The hard part for the concussion, and to play devil's advocate, and the part that kept me going was, from a neurophysiology standpoint, he said the human body wasn't designed to protect the brain from impact. He says, he goes through all of these different animals, how they're shock absorbers, how a woodpecker's tongue wraps around his head, completely around its head, so when it's pounding on that wood, the muscular tongue is basically serving to protect it. But in the human body, there's zero protection for the actual brain itself.
Good thing we're wearing an 8-pound piece of plastic.
Well, that's the, I mean,
to protect us.
That's basically what he's saying, is that's the only thing, is man had to create a helmet to dissipate that force, artificially, but naturally there is nothing. What
But, well, I mean, you can watch two rams or two, you know, like big male stags run and butt heads. And right. They put their heads down and, you know, crack. And they're,
well, he had mentioned that, and he said basically all these animals that do these things, they have
defense mechanisms
within, built in, versus the human skull does not. But like you said, we're smart enough as humans, like, we don't have anything to protect our collarbone, so thus we wear shoulder pads. You know, we don't have anything to protect our ribs, a quarterback.
Well, I didn't wear any ribs, and I wore the small shoulder pads I could find.
That's what I did.
Yeah, because I was like, dude,
on speed, bro.
Well, there was never a point where anybody, I ever hit anybody on the top of my shoulders.
That's true.
You know, like, I was always up in this, and really, I used my head as my primary. Like, that was funny. I remember I got contacted by this high school that was like, hey, you know, we're trying to recruit some ex-NFL players and different guys. The guy, I think it was Josh Booty's brother, and he was like, asked me if I wanted to come coach offensive line. And I was like, no. And I was like, how come? I'm like, I have a very unique skill set that I wouldn't fucking teach to people. And he's like, what do you mean? I'm like, dude, they would not like the way. I'm like, dude, I was taught head and hands. And I was talking like, dude, we would literally hit people as hard as we could to, like, try to get them to give the fuck up and to hurt people. And, like, that was the suicide pace. And I'm like, dude, the style of which I played, I don't want to teach people that. And I sure as hell don't want to, like, hand this to these kids. Be like, hey, man, I'm going to teach you how I played. I'm like, dude, I'm not doing that. Because you know what? These kids are going to get fucked up. And then their parents are going to be mad at me. They're going to be mad at you. I'm like, find somebody to teach us patty cake.
All right.
Because that's what they need. They need to, like, patty cake, baker's man. There's other people who teach patty cake. And, you know, like...
Different era.
No, it is. And I'm glad I got to play in that era. I'm glad that, you know, I got to play when I did. And I'm sad, of course, it didn't go longer. But, I mean, dude, when I think back on it, it went like that. But 10 years is pretty good. So I wasn't upset with that. But, you know, what's weird is it's never enough. You know? Tony Gonzalez, 17 years. Still could have been, I can still do it, I can still get out there. And, you know, finally you get to the point where you're like, yeah, I know I can do it, and you can walk away. But how many people actually get to voluntarily be like, I'm good?
Yeah.
Like Tom Brady, they're going to fucking drag him out of there.
Yeah.
Brett Favre?
Favre.
Dude, he should have fucking walked away on top, because all that shit he did at the Jets and everything, just, and the Vikings just fucking, you know, I mean, I appreciate the dick pics to the young chicks. I mean, but come on. I mean, that only works when you're the Green Bay quarterback. That don't work when you're at the fucking Jets.
No. Oh, that's
so funny. Speaking of different eras.
Oh, there you go. Speaking of dick pics.
Well, we'll get to that later. take us through a behind the scenes of the first 10 CrossFit football certs. What was the conversation like? What info got cut? What's made the cut?
So, everything got cut.
So the very first CrossFit football seminar was right over here at CrossFit Balboa. Mm-hmm. And we did not know what the fuck we were going to teach. I literally had my team of...
So just to be clear, it's still like it is today.
Exactly. Right? We didn't really know what we were going to teach. We just knew that we were going to get up and talk about methodology. We were going to teach some barbell stuff. And sprint we needed stuff. To teach some sprint, some change of direction. K-Star was there and fucking warmed everybody up like only he could fucking, I mean, I'm telling you, he can warm some people up. And he was great. I mean, he was so good that CrossFit HQ left and gave him his own seminar. So, I mean, he was good. And, you know, Raph got up and talked about, you know, his sprint stuff and the running, and it ruffled a lot of feathers because there was some pose guys like Brian McKenzie who, you know, what Raph teaches is similar to what we teach, where it's, you know, punch and hammer, you know, drive and dive, and, you know, like, let's fucking be a drag racer. And, you know, just leaning and picking up your foot isn't going to get you there. And so, like, there was a lot of battling, and it was really good. And at that point, we had to, almost after the very first one, because everybody said it was great, I had to go back and, like, recreate the seminar. Because all of a sudden, Kelly gets his own seminar, and then we go down, and we went to Tennessee Tech. The first one we taught was at Tennessee Tech, and we actually went in early and worked with their team, and then we taught a seminar at Tennessee Tech, and I had to actually get up and really think about the methodology, and ironically, all of CrossFit HQ showed up. Remember, they were like in 27 different black Escalades. We pulled up in a minivan. Session. And we pulled up in a minivan.
Yeah.
They looked like they were going to a fucking funeral.
I remember I had to kiss the ring.
Yeah, that's true. Literally. I knew that's bad. You know, Rob's out there. I'm like, what are you doing? Why are you kissing Greg's hand? Like, I don't know. I put it out there. I figured what I had to do.
I knew that. Ask for a favor.
And so I get up and I give the very, I give this intro and we're like in a classroom and I fucking bombed. I totally bombed. I know I bombed. It was terrible. I didn't know what the fuck I was talking about. I was trying to talk about like general specific. I had no fucking idea what I was talking about. And, you know, that initial bombing, actually, I think all of CrossFit HQ left after that initial talk because they knew it was so shitty they didn't have to worry about anything. So technically, it was probably probably a good idea. But, you know, we got out there and just basically did what we did. You know, we taught the basic lifts, we taught the sprinting, the running, and looked at it like what was a ready-made strength conditioning program. And then over the course of time, and then the next one, I think we taught it Blast Indy, which Raph decided not to come to. Remember that? You missed your flight?
I did.
Yeah, I don't know. Either you were pissed or
no, you didn't send my flight.
Are you
kidding? Oh, yeah.
I've seen that before.
Never got the info.
That could be right.
You fucking got the info. You just never didn't got fucking the get info. On the flight. Raph, where are you? You're like, I don't know. I'm not here. I'm like, we had a fucking seminar. So, and they lost my luggage. That's when we went to the old backpack, we don't check luggage bullshit. Yeah. So they lost all my luggage. And we had to go teach the seminar, and I had to do my best Ruiz imitation. And that was really good because we got done, and everybody's like, this is fucking great. And I was like, this was terrible. the more and more we talked, I think we just had more and more dialogue, and we were able to sit down. And
we had to figure out what we couldn't keep because.
Yeah.
We went to Dallas and we immediately realized we will never do the broad jump ever again.
Well,
because that was...
So we had this idea that CrossFit football should be a strength conditioning program to develop athletes and football players and whatever. We used to watch cut-ups, remember, at lunch? I was like, we watched cut-ups on a fucking screen. We got rid of that shit real fast. And people were like... Are we really watching Kansas City Chief cut-ups? I'm like, no, this is good. Watch this next play. Like, oh, yeah. I'm like, I got my red clicker over there. I'm like, this is fucking ridiculous. But I think what we did is we had an idea of what we wanted to teach based off of not only my training, your training, and what we were doing. And the people that showed up, we kind of thought would be at
a certain level.
Certain level. And I think what we realized fairly quickly is that we were asking people to do things so far outside the realm of what they could do that it was doing more harm than it was good.
Yeah, there's certain things weren't practical for us.
Yes. Like, I mean, we used to do banded resistant sprints, and then all of a sudden dudes are blowing caps left and right and tearing, like having these like catastrophic fucking life-ending injuries. And we're like, at the beginning I asked if people sprinted.
Yeah.
And then we realized that people don't really sprint.
Yeah, who's done change of direction? How many people haven't done
change of direction?
The next
Everybody's
year?
Like, you know, raise their hand.
Oh, yeah,
we do change of direction. And then all of a sudden,
falling everywhere.
Oh, tearing ACLs left and right. Big one, we asked somebody, hey, we're going to have you work up to a three, a heavy triple on the back squat. Have you guys done anything over 90%? Have you ever squatted a heavy triple? Yes. And then all of a sudden, you get people start adding weight to the bar. And all of a sudden, dude, like, you know, 225, you know, I squat 400 pounds and they got 225 on the bar and it looks like Ruff's, you know, preferred, you know, position, the pooping dog. Or, I mean, like, I remember one guy and I remember he's like, how'd it look? I'm like, it looked like a dog shitting a razor blade. That was the, how it looked. Like, he was like, literally, it was like a dog shitting a razor blade. That's how he looked. And he was like, that's not good. I'm like, no, that's not a good one. But, I mean, that's the... So I think what we did is we didn't really understand our audience and what they needed. I think we had some ego about what we wanted to teach them. Like, I remember you would get up and give your three-hour physiology talk.
Three and a half.
Yeah, if we were lucky. So Raph would get up and give this amazing physiology talk. And I remember at the end, people were just kind of like, their faces were like melted off. And Raph's like, you guys are strength coaches. You should understand physiology. And I remember you like got pissed and were like,
I'm out of here.
No. Raph was like, can somebody give me three muscle contractions? And we were actually in Oakland, and the only one that actually raised his hand and gave us a correct answer was Tex over there.
Yeah.
8 mile moment.
That was your 8 mile moment.
Yeah.
You know what? You had one chance to be Rabbit and you fucking made it happen.
Yeah.
But I mean, that type of deal where, you know, we just realized that the standard strength conditioning, what you would expect in terms of like, you know, I understand physiology, I understand programming. I mean, we're getting up and talking about, you know, just basic things like the idea like, hey, we're going to start with a linear progression and we're going to get in this multi-year template. And I think at least for the original crowd that we had, I mean, people really came from this CrossFit deal where it was like, you know, functional movements performed at high intensity. And as long as you're in high intensity, it doesn't really matter what the movement looks like as long as you're going harder, you know, and, you know, Greg Glassman's made a good point that the Russians and no strength or no sports scientists had contributed anything of value in the last 75 years. And then we're getting up there and teaching some really classical strength conditioning type stuff, you know, talking about Verkhoshansky and Mel Siff and this, and, you know, talking about some really basic things. And, you know, remember when we went down to Australia, where, you know, and I talked when we were talking to Ed Costner yesterday, I was like, you know, that first seminar we taught in Australia, you remember the rugby league dudes nuded up and were fucking jacked.
Beyond.
I told those guys to leave us alone because we're recording, and they're out there driving those dumpy trucks that you keep letting them fucking...
Pieces of shit. Can you hear those pieces of shit diesels? Dude,
this is what happens with a live production, though. So people got to be patient.
Yeah.
Like, well, we're living in like a cesspool.
Text Will and be like, I'm gonna, John's gonna literally burn those things.
You got it.
But
those guys are
so
dieseled.
We go down, dude.
Speaking of,
and like, so we have rugby league, rugby union, and then we got these Aussie rules dudes. And the rugby league, rugby union guys are like dazzling those cats. And there was like Blocker and I think Jeremy Austin and a bunch of those other fucks.
Red.
And yeah, those big dudes. And then all of a sudden, these rugby league dudes fucking take their shirts off. And I remember Raph, I'm like, that dude's got a muscle where his oblique is. I've never seen it. Raph's like, dude, I've never seen any of those muscles in an anatomy chart. Like, these dudes were shredded. And we got up to give the programming talk. And we were teaching this idea of, you know, glycolytic pathway. And we're going to be fucking metabolic conditioning and strength. And then these guys were talking about building an aerobic base. And all of a sudden, dude, I thought we were going to get into a fucking fist fight.
Yeah.
And those dudes are screaming at him, and I was like, whoa, let's be objective about everybody's training. And those guys are like, why? I would start with guys doing 60 to 90 minute, you know, long, slow runs, LSD stuff to build an aerobic base. And at the time, I was like, didn't want these dudes to get their asses kicked, but I was like, that's bullshit. And then here I am years later talking about, you need to build a fucking aerobic base. You know, which is, I think what I, you know, and part of the thing, you know, we did a lot of stuff with the aerobic base where, you know, we found that building a big aerobic base, you know, increases mitochondrial density, allows, you know, circulation and blood flow, allows you, you know, to ramp up recovery and all these other things. And so really looking at the body as, you know, three energy systems and training all the energy systems instead of just focusing on being good in one. So I think that was a real good learning, but I think what was really nice about the CrossFit football seminar is it allowed us to develop concepts in real time as we were presenting them, and then develop concepts off of the attendees that came.
Yep.
And then really, like Raph said, like we had an idea of what we wanted to teach. I mean, I remember we were in Denmark, and we just threw the fucking seminar out. Like, Raph's like, I'm not teaching this shit. These guys, they can't do it. Let's fuck them up.
Yeah,
and we went in and just literally just like fucking flipped the script and just ran a different seminar because like the basic concepts that we were trying to get over were just not working. So, you know what, we had to work it on the fly. And I think what you've seen over the last 7 years is an evolution, a refinement to where, you know, if you saw it now, Raph, it like runs and it's very good and it's digestible. But we had to literally trim out so much because it just... couldn't teach it. I mean,
I got to guest sit on one in Charlotte.
Oh, that's right, you did.
Yeah,
right.
When they came in and those guys ran a really good one, so it was streamlined.
Yeah.
I think a way to kind of describe it too is like the audience, you know how you're saying you have to read the audience, and you figure like a metronome kind of hitting back and forth. Mm-hmm. But like over time, you swing to like, it swings to these extremes where you show up to a certain, like Denmark, there's now a population that is so incapable, blaming it on injuries. Maybe that's true, maybe it's not. And then you have potentially have people there that are so freaking capable, it's almost like the drills may or may not be a waste of time for them. So you gotta figure out, just off the cusp, you have to have that coaching bandwidth, like, okay, provide a similar experience, then focus your attention on this guy to give him what he needs to get better, you know, and it's just kind of this back and forth.
We've had, like we were in Las Vegas, remember? We had Grant Winstrom showed up, and, like, you know, Grant, like, a contemporary and a buddy of mine, a guy I played against. And
200 pounds lighter.
No, he was probably, like, 120. He played at, what, like, 270, 280? He's, like, 50 pounds. Looking good. He was fucking shredded up.
He was.
And, dude, he came out and brought all of his coaches and his wife. And, dude, he... I will forever... Dude, I always respected him and liked him as a player because the dude played his ass off. But the dude showed up completely with the exact same attitude that you want everybody to have. I'm an empty cup, dude. This sounds great. Let's fucking do it. And was like, I'm in. This stuff's amazing. And, like, busted his ass. We were running, like, suicide sprints on a basketball court. Mm-hmm. And we're fucking... I'm out there racing him. You know, like, it was just one of those things where, you know, that's the type of person you want. But yet we've also run into other people that were fucking fought us every step of the way.
Well, it's interesting because you look at the evolution of the CrossFit Football Seminar, where it started out within a community that just wanted to have their ass handed to them. And it ended up being a situation like all they hear when any of us are giving our lecture is wah, 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 wah. Okay, when's the next WOD? Yeah. Wait, you know, just let's go. And then as it got around and people are like, wow, they're actually teaching something that is useful. And that, I think that was our hard time, was how do we balance out the guys that just want to get crushed, who don't care what we have to say, versus, you know, here's somebody who really, hey, I'm a coach, I have no idea what I'm doing, teach me what to do with my high school football team.
You remember we were in Denver,
yes,
and that guy was not a CrossFitter, heard about the seminar from a buddy of his. You got to go to this. And that was the guy, you remember, that created that whole training program off of the carpet rolls and went to the junkyard and developed his whole strength conditioning program based off of shit that he found at the junkyard and didn't know any of the CrossFit stuff. Didn't know anything. But, like, and then we wrote programming. This guy wrote, like, this beautiful mind program that I wish I'd saved, that was the best program that's ever been written across a football seminar, and there was zero CrossFit in it. The guy had Chevy 350 blocks with handles. They had chains. They had these carpet bag rolls that these kids would Zercher squat.
And he could back everything up.
Yeah, and then the guy was showing me YouTube videos. And they were the worst team, and they became the best team. And, like, this dude was, like it was the embodiment of everything that we ever hoped to do with the seminar was what this guy did organically, and he came to us. And literally, like, that to me was... something where I took a huge step back and I was like, I need to unfuck myself and I need to pull my head out of my own ass and I need to realize that there are people out there doing really amazing things and we need to start encompassing them and really offering them stuff. And really, like, that was kind of the advent and really my first mindset with Power Athlete, you know. And what really spurred this whole thing was a blog post. I got an email from a guy that said, hey, what would the CrossFit football look like if there was no CrossFit in it? Like, how would you write a program for somebody that wasn't a CrossFitter? And that was what I wrote, which was the Power Athlete template, which ended up becoming Power Athlete. Which is, and then I realized, like, hey, there was a market for something where people were, you know, just not increased work capacity, broad time mobile domains. The idea to, you know, seamlessly and effortlessly combine primal movement patterns, you know, through space to accomplish a known and novel task. The idea of developing athleticism. That's my definition of athleticism.
I like it.
And you know, putting that together and looking at it and being like, you know, if fitness has this, you know, this idea that, you know, sickness, wellness, and health, that there's a continuum of athleticism, that there's never a point that you cannot continue to develop your athleticism. You can be 80 years old and working on becoming a better athlete. And that the never-ending continuum is actually developing athleticism. And all things being equal, the better athlete will be the better competitor. And so... what, as much as I thought I knew as an athlete, when I started teaching the CrossFit Football Seminar, it probably was, and I won't say probably, it is one of the most enlightening things I've ever done, because not only did I get the opportunity to travel the world and meet people that were doing a program that they found organically on the internet, and then I got to show up in Bodø, Norway, New Zealand.
Bodø was cool.
Yeah, we went to the Arctic Circle to teach a seminar. I mean, we showed up.
We ate whale.
We did eat whale. And we drank Miad.
Miad.
Which was, like, fucking fire. And And the sun never went down, which was also weird. But, I mean, so here's this program we put out on the internet, and people find it organically, they do the program, and then we travel and meet them. And every single person had the same same deal. I got stronger. No shit. I got faster. I did better. I was a better athlete. I, you know, this program is developing. And the word I heard is that I'm able to move better. And I'm like, why? What is it about the program that forces people to move better? And you know what? They couldn't tell me. They were like, I don't know. I just do this stuff. And then I realized a lot of people just don't give a fuck. People just want to be better. And however you get there is however you get there. And so then I looked at it as almost my responsibility to look at it and say, all right, if they don't care, then I have to care. And I got to understand it. And I got to step my game up. And over time, just meeting all the people organically and like seeing all the information and really Talk to Me Johnnie was writing that blog while angering and therapeutic really helped me formulate my own ideas on just a lot of different things. And it forced me to research a lot of things that I hadn't really thought about. And then based on that, you just kind of come out and, you know, and then what's interesting is, you know, you start here, you think you get here, and then you go back to here and you realize that, you know, everything that we worked on for all those years when I was training with Raph is as true today as it ever was.
You know, that's a good point, where one of our identity crisis when we first started was we had this idea of how athletes should train, but we ran into logistical problems with facilities where we were like, hey, let's do change of direction. And we were used to doing it on our mat or turf.
Sure.
And then the original, when CrossFit started to blow up, was, hey, go get a concrete warehouse. Go get a you know, little storefront that had zero capabilities for doing what we effectively wanted to do. And now you look at the evolution of how CrossFit has changed, where a lot of the boxes are now going towards, hey, you know, don't get this 500 square foot facility, get this 5,000 square foot facility and turf it and look like a college strength and conditioning weight room.
We taught a seminar in Texas. That's where we met Gail Yakum from CrossFit Strong. And I always remember Gail Yakum's name from CrossFit Strong, because he was the guy that told me, I'm going big. I'm open 18,000 square feet. I'm like, your first CrossFit gym? Don't know shit about it. Just got my level one. I'm going fucking all in. And he literally pushed it in. And periodically people check on CrossFit Strong. And the reason being is, I remember the joke is, I'm like, CrossFit Strong, huh? And he's like, yeah, it's a great name. I'm like, but you're not strong. He's like, well, I'm like, yeah, you're not strong, yo. And, but he's got a big gym and he kicked ass and he fucking went big. I mean, he saw the writing on the wall and he's got like, you know, a bunch of coaches, but he had a big spot and turf and really saw the evolution of what you wanted to create. Was you need a place for people to push prowlers. You got to be able to sprint and move. That keeping your feet on the ground and just going up and down, whether it be in a thruster or a squat or any of these other things, isn't going to allow you to develop athleticism. And we found that out at Virginia Beach. We went and taught at Tony Blauer's place, and one of the original CrossFit OGs, Brandon Gillum, came to our seminar, and Brandon fucking thruster his ass off, looked great, super strong dude, could not change direction to save his fucking life.
It was brutal.
Super great guy, and I was joking with him. I kept calling him Zoolander. I'm like, you're an Andy Turner. He couldn't turn left, but he couldn't turn right either. So he wasn't an Andy Turner. He was a
no turner.
But I mean, I remember
standing up really tall.
And I remember rapping with him. I was like, dude, tell me about your training. Oh, like he literally classic. And I remember being like, it wasn't his fault. Like, and that's the original joke. And you guys still hear me at the CrossFit football seminar talk about the Goodwill Hunting moment where I like hugged him. I'm like, it's not your fault. He's like, not you, man. And like, that's what it came down to. I'm like, it's not your fault. Like, we're teaching complex movement patterns that you haven't developed. Why would you think that you would be good at these? And that was, you know, and then I think people realized it when they were like, oh, if I want to be able to change direction and move through space, I should probably change your direction and move through space. And I should understand how to put my foot in the ground and, you know, foot position, and that if I do 100,000 squats with my toes out, then all of a sudden when I go to plant, I'm going to default to that position that I've reinforced. And that's when we started getting into the toes forward model. Which everybody fucked up, because they started going here and then they started driving their knees out past the toe box. Mm-hmm. And we always wanted the knees to track over the insteps, and our pyramid
push
position.
Push your butt back, yeah.
Yeah, push your butt back, get in that good position. Don't drive your knees out so hard. And so, like, it was, I mean, talk about that whole thing going fucking jumping the shark. I'm literally watching a, you know, K-Star, these guys arguing it, and I'm like, oh, God, I want to go watch Fonzie jump the shark right now. But, yeah, I mean, it was...
Bench.
Oh, yeah, we each have the 225 bench program.
Because we started this with the idea that we were going to do, like, a combine.
Dude, we were going to do a combine. We were going to have vertical jump, so we would bring the Vertec with us.
We traveled with the Vertec.
We traveled with a Vertec. That's why we
have
it.
Terrible idea.
It's fucking right over there.
Terrible.
We still have it. You see it over there?
Yeah.
So I had to travel with the Vertec. We had a Vertec, and we also had, you know, obviously our projector so we could watch cut-ups, and I had to bring my computer so we could watch DVD cut-ups of fucking football.
Boxes of waivers.
Yeah. Sure. Boxes of waivers. Thank God we met Luke, who put it all on the internet. I was like, you can do that? You can sign your name electronically? Luke's like, yeah, don't worry about that.
I am a hoarder of sorts. I have still those fucking cut up DVDs out here. We should fucking just, you know, have a few brews and throw in those cut ups. See what's up.
Oh, you mean the
ones from the original cert?
Oh, yeah. I know you do. They're in my desk.
That's awesome.
But like, what was interesting is, you know, we had this idea that we were going to test people and we were going to put them through a combine. And so one of them was a 225 bench. And I believe the record was like 40 in, we had this dude from Canada. We were teaching a seminar in Toronto. And this big bodybuilder dude came in with his wife, who was like a fitness chick. And they took our seminar, heard it was great, showed up, and the dude hit like 39 or 40 reps. Yeah. And I used to fucking lay down and do it, and he hit 40, and I didn't fucking ever do it again. I used to like one-up people all the time. I'd be like, oh yeah, no problem, I got this for fucking 30. The dude was like 31, 32. I was like, nope. Never doing it again. It's over. But then what happened? Fucking blown pecs?
Blown pecs.
People and why?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, so the 225 would blow pecs and why? Because people weren't prepared for it. And
push-ups. That's all they had, right?
Well, yeah. I mean, because you know, because the bench press wasn't functional.
Exactly, it wasn't a functional movement because it wasn't hip to extremity. Yeah. I was one of those guys. I know what's up.
Right. So you know, and then I talked about it, and I was like, well, if you don't believe the bench press is functional movement, I want you to come over here, and I want you to stand about 18 inches from me, and I'm going to punch you as hard as I can in the chest. And at that point, you're going to see the definition of a functional movement. I did that to Kelly Starrett. He was like, no, the bench press isn't functional. And I went, wham, I'm going to hit Kelly. And he was like, and like, dude, as he goes down, he's like, fuck you, stop my heart. My fucking heart skipped a beat. And to this day, he's like, he will never get within arm striking distance of me. He's like, honestly, it's like a gorilla in the cage. He's like, I'm never going to get like stay 18 inches and at 19. But like that, so people blew pecs. And caps left and right.
Yeah.
And we had a lot of rolled ankles. And like that was a big thing too for us, is like looking and being like, don't wear those shoes. Why? You're gonna roll an ankle. How do you know? Because for the last 7 seminars, everybody that's worn those shoes has rolled their ankle. So the original Nanos, people were blowing out their ankles left and right. And that's why we ended up going to Vans, because the Vans have such a wide base, and we're able to kind of put the foot in the ground. They were light enough, and regardless how old and shitty your Vans are, they never really lose that flat waffle deal. So that's why we started wearing the Vans. So, but it was really interesting. I mean, in the early days, we almost had to convince people of things. Like, we would get up and present these things, and people would push back. And I think over time, we didn't have to convince people as much. And I think it's because the people became more educated, or we just fucking beat them over the head more.
Well, I think... because the initial offering within this community was fed, you know, force-fed into a certain route, and when it's sold with enough passion, it's accepted as tried and true.
Sure.
And it wasn't until people started Googling and saying, hey, you know, fitness and developing better athletes and sports performance wasn't created, you know, by this certain entity, you know, people have been doing this for a very long time, and just like anything, and what we were talking about earlier is the games this year will drive people, because it exposed a lot of weaknesses. It exposed people to change of direction, and people all of a sudden are saying, you know what, let's figure out what people are doing to change directions better, because, you know, obviously
Well, we're going to reach out, you know, to some of the CrossFit athletes that we work with, and you know, Tex worked with Chrissy Atkins.
Toast Ford.
It really helped her, and you know, the idea of teaching people. I mean, I remember I went to go teach the sled push a couple years ago at that seminar or for CrossFit HQ, and you know, I didn't really. It was kind of ironic because they had that big push sled on concrete. And the easiest way to drive a sled on concrete is head and hands and drive into it, push onto it. Then all of a sudden, when they brought the sled out for the games, they put it on grass.
Oof.
And I remember like going out there and being like, let's demo this thing. And I went to head and hands it, and I couldn't move it.
Oh yeah.
And I was like, dude, you guys are, and I also realized people were going to break their fucking necks when they were tired. So I was like, hey, we're going to put the shoulder into it. And I was like, I want you to lean on it and drive this thing, because there's no way to get momentum. You guys don't have enough mass. So I literally changed the technique of everybody. And then all of a sudden CrossFit put out the video, and then they saw the people doing a different technique, and they were like, people were losing their mind. They're like, what? They didn't fucking listen to a thing that Wellborn said. Why the fuck did they bring them out there? And I was like, dude, they didn't show me fucking demoing and being like, hey, a metal sled on concrete is completely different than a metal sled that has weight on it on fucking wet grass. And I was like, the only way you guys are going to survive this thing is head and hands and fucking short choppy steps. So, but you know what, like there's an opportunity, I think, to look at, you know, and I think you're going to see this with CrossFit. I mean, the, you know, if the metabolic conditioning and your conditioning is all equal, you know, your efficiency in movement and, you know, your athleticism are going to become, you know, the
equalizer.
Yeah, the equalizer.
Or something that puts you above and beyond.
Yeah, I mean, I was really impressed by Matt Frazier this year. I mean, who's a high-level Olympic lifter. And the guy's got that in his bucket, and all he had to do is develop an engine and create more capacity, and then the dude goes out and crushes it and ran away with it. I mean, there was really no, you know, never a point at which anybody he thought he was not going to be able to win it. So, and then we watched the girls. I mean, the Katrina, or was it Katrin David's daughter? Dude, awesome. Unbelievable. Her movement from when she, you know, a couple of years ago compared to what she had now, I mean, she's just really matured and is such just a more pleasing athlete to watch. So, I mean, I think that's where it's really going to go, that, you know, the fitness is going to become, you know, almost like a full cup. Everybody's going to fill their cup of, like, their capacity, and now it's going to become that never-ending thread of trying to constantly develop athleticism. And I think that's something that I think we do really well and do better than just about anybody else on the planet, is the idea to assess people, figure out why they're not better athletes, and then work to develop athleticism, which I firmly believe you can develop.
So on the subject of athleticism, this may or may not be an inside job, you're saying it's a combo of primal movements.
Ooh.
I've never heard this term.
Oh.
Maybe. Can you guys walk through the primal movement patterns and maybe use that human pelvis on the table?
I will defer this to Raphael because I actually have... Well, we teach this at the seminar with primal movement patterns, but I learned this and have, you know, stolen this from, or I didn't steal it, I just borrowed it.
You're inspired.
It will inspire, but you know what, here's a big thing. I don't claim to have invented this shit. I learned, you know, this conversation and what Raph's about to do, I mean, came over the course of many, many years when I was talking about the idea of a bilateral hip hinge versus, you know, changing the iliac crest and, you know, the idea to step and lunge and how do you step. I mean, all of these things were done, and I remember very vividly training with Raph one of the first times. I mean, I was a big squatter. I mean, I squatted, you know, 600 pounds before I was 20, and all of a sudden we're in there squatting big weights, and Raph was like, oh, looks pretty good. Let's go do some lunging. I was like, all right. And I couldn't do a bodyweight lunge. And Raph's like, so you play football and you run, and you're on one leg a lot. And I'm like, yeah. And he's like, but you can't lunge? And then that's when we developed all the drunk steps and the transverse, and we started working on different ways of loading with the dumbbells and all these different movements. And we started doing it on a gymnastics floor. So it was a squishy floor, take off your shoes, and when you would step, there would be, you know, that kind of weird kind of stability to be able to hold yourself. And like, we weren't trying to create the floor other than probably it was just, you know, there the opportunity for us. But all of these different movement patterns and the idea of the X, Y, and Z axis you're going to talk about really just became ferreted out. And then what I would do, because I wasn't married, didn't have any kids, and really had no life, after I would train, we would go eat, and then we would come back, and Raph had his education components with his interns. And I was always sitting there, and I would listen and watch. And it was really educational for me, and you know, I really had no desire to ever get into strength coaching and helping people and doing this. I mean, we came out, I was gonna play football forever. I was gonna die, and you know what, I was gonna play football, and I was gonna die about the same time Jesus Christ died, 33 years old. That's all I was gonna live for. And here I am at 40. Can't believe I made it this long. So, Rob, please, let's talk about primal movement patterns. And
well, basically what happens is all human movement, number one, has to originate from the spine. Stabilization of the position of the spine. Now, not every position of the spine is going to be optimal, but our job is to create an optimal position of the spine and then allow movements to occur off of that. So from the upper body, it would be multiplanar push or pull. So the ability to push or push or push or push in a 6 degrees of, or 3 degrees of axes of rotation or three translational planes. And then on that same boat, it's pulling. So pushing and pulling on all three of those and three. But when you get to the pelvis, basically we treat the primal movements as, if we were to take a three-dimensional model of this, like a wonderful pen going through the x-axis, and if we were to rotate on that axis, that would be what's basically termed as a squat.
Or what we know as a bilateral hip hinge.
Bilateral hip hinge, which from anatomical purposes will say anterior and posterior pelvic tilt.
And those movements would be like a squat, squat, like a kettlebell swing, a kipping pull-up.
RDLs.
An RDL, a deadlift, a clean, a snatch, a muscle-up.
Yeah. So basically anything where the pelvis is rolling forward and backward. Now, if you look at basically three-dimensional model, we've got a y-axis, so coming straight down. And so from this position, if we were to rotate on that, it would be right to left rotation. So the left hip coming forward, the right hip coming forward, the left hip coming forward, the right hip coming forward. Basically, that's what occurs on a primal movement of a lunge. Basically.
And Raph uses the term primal not in like the Mark Sisson sense of like Croc running through the Serengeti with the loincloth. He's using primal, and the word primal really means basic.
Basic.
So these are the most basic primal movement pattern because they are really the foundation of our skeleton. I mean, this is, you know, if you watch a baby, I mean, they roll over. Yep. And like you watch them get into a position, they push themselves from a squat into a stand.
Crawling,
they
squat,
push up,
and then they stand
up. They end
up,
and then what do? They fall forward, and they put their leg in front of each other. I mean, it's literally like I've watched my kids, you know, crawl into a, you know, and push themselves up into the squat, and you're like, oh my God, primal movement patterns, you know?
Last piece of the puzzle is your three-dimensional Z-axis. So if that axis of rotation is coming right through the middle of the pelvis, coming out the back end, the movement would be rotation here, so lateral elevation rights and left, lateral elevations rights and left. So that three-dimensional model would be basically a step-up position of anything that is laterally flexing. Either the torso is coming down to laterally flex or the pelvis is rising up to lift you up like a step-up.
What I always think about, too, is like the changing of elevation of the iliac crest. So, mm-hmm. You know, you like obviously right here, and then you watch the orientation changing this way when one goes up. So that's how I know for that Z-axis.
So the way we look at it is, in a simple way that I've learned to describe this is, you basically think of the primal movements as either letters, basic letters of a vocabulary, but one thing that resonates well is notes on a keyboard. And you can learn all of these basic movements, but it isn't until you start sequentially putting them together where you start to move from infant to child. And then eventually the body should learn to pattern those in parallel. So they'll start putting not A, B, C, D, E, F, G, but A and B together, or A and C together, or A, C to D, F, G, H. And then you'll see masterful athletes that start to play a symphony or...
That's what we call the language of movement.
Language of movement.
Can you speak just, you know, one auditory, you know, note opposed from being able to create complex arguments and sentences is the same thing in the idea of, you know, language of movement.
And so that's basically the body is taking those, and the body is a computer that solves problems. And so any problem that the, and that's the hard part for a lot of our athletes to understand is movement
athletic
is a problem.
Athletic problem solving.
Athletic problem solving.
So what you guys also forget is that after the seminars, we would go drink beers and we would eat and we would have these conversations. But it was always like, fuck. And I remember, it might have been in Naperville, we were sitting, we went to this steakhouse, and I remember Raph was like at his darkest moment, like that was like, I think like, he no longer saw the light at the
was
end of the tunnel.
Was that because of Luke?
It was probably because of Luke.
Listen, I was there, I was asking all the hard questions, making you guys justify your witchcraft, and there was good answers, so I bought in. And here I am, you're still fucking, possessed.
Snowed.
So
that was the breaking
point. I remember sitting there, and part of the thing was like after this on Saturday, the host would always be like, "Hey, you guys want to go out to dinner?" Or I was like, "No, we're good." And they'd be like, "Why?" I'm like, "Because we're gonna go talk shit about you, and we don't want to do it in front of you." So we were literally, and I distinctly remember us having the conversation of athletic problem solving, the idea that if you give somebody like a complex problem to solve. And you know you have to teach them basic movements. It's kind of like if I give you like, hey, I need you to get to on top of this mountain, but I've never taught you to read a compass and I've never taught you to read a map and you don't know anything about sun and positioning and all these other different ways. There's hundreds of ways for you to get up on that. You could have GPS, you could have a map, you could have a compass. You could follow the moss on the trees and know that the sun breaks there and that you know it's going this way, so I gotta go this way. So there's a million different ways to solve that problem to get from point A to point B. Now, you are going to use the one that you're most able to use, and the one you've been taught, and the one that you've most rehearsed.
Your habit.
But then, when you talk about athletic problem solving, what do people default to? What do you think? What do you think they default to?
Their training.
Yeah.
Whatever
they habitually reinforce.
What are we talking about? Every reification, what do they do? They always follow the level of their training. So whatever you've done the most becomes your habit, which becomes your default. And so when you look at athletic problem solving, if your default is an answer that can't be, you know, that doesn't apply to that problem, like for example, I don't do any overhead pulling. Okay, well, I need you to get up on top of there and then you have no ladder. Oh, well, I don't know how to get up there, I don't do pulling. And you're like, well, then you're not getting up there. So then you have to figure out a way, well, I'm really good at squatting. Can I box jump up there? Can I do a broad jump? Can I get up there? Yeah, no, I don't know. Can you jump up there? Let's give it a shot. You know, and the analogy we figured out a long time ago was if I locked you in a cage and you couldn't leave the cage until you squatted that 500 pounds, how would you squat 500 pounds? And people were like, I don't know. Can I take weight off the bar? I'm like, yeah. Well, I'd probably squat as heavy as I could and I would just keep maxing out every day or I'd build a training program where I just kept working up to that. And I was like, yeah, you would have to develop, an equation to help you squat 500 pounds, just like for an equation for me as a, you know, white middle class kid trying to play football in the NFL, I knew that there was two things. One is I was going to have to hit people, then they hit harder than me, and I was going to have to be a knee bender. That was it. I had to play low with leverage. These guys were too big and they were too strong for me. Then I had to figure out what my gift was. So you develop, athletic problem solving, and, you know, that to me was really interesting, where the people at the seminar were given a certain set of tools to work with, and when they came to the seminar, they did not have the tools to necessarily master what we were trying to teach them.
And the problem you run into that most people will have too much faith in their ability to rise to the occasion, yeah. and they do what we always say, and it's you square peg round hole.
Yeah.
Like if your biomechanical habit has you going toes out, knees out,
yeah,
then every time you change directions, you can't do it. They're physiologically, it's impossible to go toes forward, because if you turn, orient your toes forward, then your whole body will shift. And so it just becomes this constant frustration of square peg, round hole, square peg, round hole, square peg. I don't know how to do the square peg, round hole.
Yeah, we see people frustrated.
And it's over and over. And the only thing that you could do is take an extra hop, to decrease that amount of inertia that's being placed on you, or your foot sticks in the floor
and you fall.
Yeah, or you injure yourself. So,
and I think, you know, you're in that position, you're dealing with a population where the recipe for success is effort. And no matter how hard you try, if you are not in that correct position,
square peg round
hole. Yeah, square peg round hole. So all of a sudden, effort isn't rewarded. Like, it becomes frustrating.
Well, yeah, I mean, it comes back to the idea that the only thing that matters is the end result. Mm-hmm. I don't care how you got there. I just want to know you got on that mountain. I don't care that you tried hard. Good. I mean, effort is implied. I expect everybody to try as hard as they can every day. The problem is that, you know, they don't give gold medals for effort.
Correct.
I mean, you watch it. It's not like they have the spirit of the games at the CrossFit, like they do at the CrossFit Games, where they like give the spirit of the games and they give, like, they bring people up that have been there and busted their ass that might not have won, that have done this. They give the people that, which is fucking great. There's no spirit of the games in the Olympics. Fuck you. You didn't win a gold, you fade in anonymity. And I think, like, football is big in that too. I mean, I had a guy recently the other day, I was like, oh, hey, do you know John Michaels? And I was like, yeah, he played at USC. They brought him in, traded him from Green Bay. He was a first-round draft pick, came to Philly, and they actually brought him in when I was a rookie to start at right tackle. And I ended up beating him out. He got cut. And I think he's like an orthopedic surgeon now or something. Super smart dude. Nicest guy on the fucking planet. And, you know, like there's, you know, like an opportunity where a guy had all the world, you know, had first-round draft pick, whatever, and can't do it. So you know what? You got to go. And you know what? And then the guy, you know, saves his money, whatever, goes on, and now he's an orthopedic surgeon. He's probably kicking ass while, you know, laughing at all these broke-ass, dumb, you know, fucking NFL players killing themselves and doing stupid shit. You know, blowing their money on fucking rims and weed and, you know,
jewelry.
So, but that in itself is kind of the, you know, the bigger picture of it. And it's like, you know, like these complex ideas and like the idea that there's an equation for movement, there's an equation for athleticism. And I think the big thing is people just kind of look at athleticism like either you have it or you don't. It's absolutely. Like, can you be better looking? Can you be more athletic?
Absolutely. But I think the problem is it's still a comparative value where people are still trying to compare themselves to the great John Wilborn.
Oh, and it's fuck like, you.
It's like, don't.
God damn you.
It's like, just be.
I'm a fucking hack.
Be a better mate, be a better Raph kind of thing, and because in the end, that's really what it's all about.
Well, but isn't that fucking human nature? Like, I mean, how many people are, and I always think this too, like how many people are watching the Olympics and being like, I can't do that?
Everybody.
Like, everybody.
No, I take it back. I would say half. I would say there's half of the population that is smart enough to know
they can't do it.
I can't
do
that.
And then there's another half of the population like, I could totally do that if only my parents had put me.
Yes.
What the fuck? This place is falling down. If only my parents had put me in gymnastics.
Absolutely.
If only I had had a swimming pool.
I laugh about swimming all the time. How many people are watching 100, a 50? A 50. You know, what was that thing that we talked about? Bill Murray had a great tweet.
He said, the idea that you should have an average person.
That would be
just
epic.
To give perspective.
Epic.
It should be Tex on the swim.
I love average, though. That's why they don't do it.
Well, we could find like even like a high level swimmer. Like I was thinking like the girl we just met at the Barbabel, Colleen Fauch. So she's a cowgirl, and you know, whenever I see cow athletes, I always try to, you know, connect with them a little bit. But I mean, she was a sprinter and, you know, super strong. Like you bring somebody that was actually a high level, like collegiate, and then put them in these situations. And you're like, so this is somebody that got a scholarship that was a high level swimmer. Mm-hmm. Let's see how they do in comparison, you know, or you know, you watch, you know, like just even people that were, you know, scholarship athletes.
Right.
You know, I remember guys that, you know, like they get a lot of scholarships in football, and guys would come out and they were only there a short period of time.
Raph, I think this is a good time to introduce the Shades of Awesome.
Go, Shades of Awesome. Well, it's really interesting. Where
it's just like your 50 Shades of Grey. But
it is. It's the exact same thing. It's the exact thing. Can we dim the lights?
I was going to say, do I have to get a blindfold? Because I'm okay with it. I mean, you know.
Well, I think I've learned over the years that you take fitness, for instance, where somebody might get into fitness through whatever means. You might get into CrossFit, you might get into P90X, you might get into something.
Well, you know what it is? It's all about muscle confusion.
Muscle confusion, that's P90X, right?
If you confuse your muscles,
you'll get jacked like that guy.
Yeah, they do.
So in that instance, you get success from that, and you immediately think that is the greatest thing since sliced bread. Sure. That is awesome.
That's all I need.
But then next thing you know, you might get involved with something else, and you realize...
Like Zumba.
You add Zumba to your program.
Next thing you know.
And next thing you know, shake weight.
Next thing you know, we're out at a Latin club, and you're out there fucking shaking up doing your Zumba moves.
And having some strange Latin man rub upon me.
Don't you want to feel dangerous, but not too dangerous?
And it's awesome.
Yeah, and it's awesome.
And I think that's that spectrum that most of us, you know, as we dive into something, you think, oh, that's great. And then you don't know what you don't know. And all of a sudden you're like, okay, CrossFit, basic CrossFit HQ is why? Because they don't give it to you.
Because you don't know it.
Ooh.
But people are like, you don't know what you don't know. I'm like, well, why don't you know? And they're like, because you don't know it. I'm like, oh, this makes so much sense now.
And so it's one of those things Steve Jobs, you know, did a great job of saying, you know, the customers don't know what they want because I haven't made it for them yet.
Yeah.
And it ends up being one of those situations that Shades of Awesome are, the more you learn, the more you realize that you don't know, and there's a significantly higher and higher and higher peak that you can keep climbing up. But some people will never get to that point.
My only regret in life, and I'll tell you this, my only regret is that I did not write the CrossFit Football Power Athlete book 7 years ago. And the reason being is I thought I knew way more. And Rob Wolf and I joke about this all the time. He's like, honestly, you should have written it, because then you would go back now and realize what a fucking dipshit you are. Mm-hmm. He goes, I go back and read my book and realize, like, fuck, I got to rewrite this thing. And he goes, that's why you have different editions. You got to put it out there. And that is the snapshot of what you know at that period in that time. If you're waiting to when you know enough, it's kind of like the age old, like, I'm going to have kids when I'm ready. You're
never ready.
You're never going to be ready to have kids. Never. Right? And you know what? They just show up. And like I remember, like my wife was pregnant, and I could see that something was growing in her stomach. It just didn't really register. I knew that there were little organisms in there, but it doesn't really register. You just kind of see it. It's more real for the woman. Like there's these things inside of her growing. Like us, we're like, I don't know. She looks like she's getting a big tummy. Right? And then all of a sudden, those things come out. You see them, and you're like, it's fucking go time. And you know what? Like I always meet people like, oh, we're not ready to have kids yet. We're not financially ready. It is, and you're never ready. You're fucking never ready. You never know enough. There's never a point at which I've ever thought, I got this figured out. It's just not. I mean, like, think about the things that we talk about even, you know, with training, or we read something, we hear something, we hear a different perspective. I mean, like, even rapping with Ed Costner, I mean, just being like, yeah, I realized after doing all this that the basics work, and you just get people strong and let them go play their sport. Don't get too fucking jiggy about it. Whereas other people are over there being like, oh, well, you know, we're going to do a 3-rep down, 1 count, you know. And he was like, yeah, we did time reps because those fuckers didn't want to squat deep. So I made them do pause squats. Mm-hmm. Surprisingly, they squatted deep. I mean, you know, like that stuff is, you know, it gives you perspective and gives you understanding. But also, you know, there's people that don't do that. They don't believe that anybody had anything value before. And I think that's a huge mistake.
I think the art of coaching is understanding, number one, that everything works. You just have to know where to put it in.
Well, everything works, but not everything works forever.
Correct. You just got to know where to place it.
It's like fucking being in Kung Fu. You guys are too young. You never saw Kung Fu with David Carradine.
I mean, I saw it in the office.
Raph, we were raised on this idea. There was like Kung Fu where like David Carradine would have these flashbacks to where he was with his blind Kung Fu master, mm-hmm. who literally was the king of rhetorical questions. Like the guy would ask him these things, like these statements, like go back and watch it. It's awesome. Hilarious. He's like, why does the grasshopper hop twice as far as the, you know, whatever. I don't know. And they're like, oh, you know, it's just like they were the most like esoteric questions. And I remember, I think we grew up in that generation where you're like, somewhere there's some blind master that's going to ask me questions. That's going to force me to think, to take me down this road. And you realize Kung Fu is just a TV show.
I have one more question.
You're crazy.
And this is this is for Raph. So John, you don't have to talk. Tell us about your programming on Train Heroic. what's the desired adaptation and who is it for? And then I'll just throw this in because I know John's dying to hear it or hear you answer it. And where did you get the program name from?
I wanted to be more in motion.
God damn you.
I wanted to be a little bit more in motion. Actually, the funny thing about that was I used to use Train Heroically all the time. That was something that I tell my athletes all the time. whenever they were afraid to either go up and wait, whenever they were afraid to get out of their comfort zone, I'm like, you got to train heroically, you got to train heroically. And then you guys created that, and I was like, dang it.
We didn't create it.
Can we add that?
So you know what they did? And personally, I thought the name was kind of stupid. But they wrote down all these names, and they went to a bar, and they asked people which one they liked.
Awesome.
And that's how they ended up with Train Heroic.
That's how they got it.
You know, I...
What was second place, did they say?
They did, but
it was really shitty.
None of them were good.
No, none of them were good.
But I'll tell you what, I couldn't have done any better, so I'm not casting stuff.
Well, yeah, no, I mean, it was great, but, Train Heroic... Raphael's standard pitch phrase, be courageous. Like... If I could, like, close, and I do, I close my eyes often, I imagine Raphael is my, you know, kung fu master, except he has contacts, so he looks blind. And ironically, when I first met Raph, he had long hair.
I did.
And it kind of threw me for a loop. And
like how long?
Like, shoulder length.
Yeah.
Like, he looked like Brandon Lee the Bruce Lee story. And then, why did you cut it? It had to do something like your vanity. Like, I remember we saw the movie Seven, and you like thought that you were the Bane guy,
and you shaved it off.
Man, was he okay? Yeah, and then all of a sudden,
I think it was Seven.
Yeah, we saw the movie Seven, and it was the Seven Mortal Sins, and Roth realized his hair.
I'm not gonna be vanity.
Yeah, and he shaved it. I mean, I saw The Matrix and was searching for the blue pill. So, I mean, who knows? I have a blue pill and a red pill.
Take them both.
Why did I take the red pill?
As far as the programming is, the programming is designed to help somebody move better, flat out. That's it's really designed as a non-specific. If somebody needs to take everything that we've done in terms of a comprehensive program that will develop that. So not a football player, not a basketball player, and it goes along with what we originally started the conversation with in terms of sports specific. There came a point where I learned and I had a question, me being the flag bearer, one of the flag bearers of sports specificity was, I looked at what we did well with football players. I'm going to get somebody to run high, run fast, jump high, be agile, be powerful. And then I said, but we're going to be sports specific with baseball, which involves running fast, jumping high, and changing
but direction. Rotation and organized grab ass.
Yeah, take out the organized grab ass, but nothing changed across the board of what I was looking at. I said, okay, you know, the basketball coach said, do you have a program for basketball players? Yeah, it involves being quick and agile jumping high.
It's like a car that's too fast or a girl that's too good looking or that guy's way too funny. Like, these are things you don't, like...
They don't exist.
It doesn't exist. It's not like, that guy was way too athletic to be here. No, it doesn't happen.
And so what I started to learn about how I wanted to approach this was, it wasn't up to me to make somebody a better basketball player. It was their mom and dad who had the genetics to make their child 6'6". It wasn't me that was gonna make somebody a better gymnast. It was somewhere down their heritage, their genome said, you're not gonna grow above 5'2".
So you're gonna be a gnome.
So you're just gonna be a gnome or a world-class gymnast. I'm not gonna make you a better swimmer. It's the fact that I'm gonna make you a better athlete. It's your freak shoulder flexibility and your ankles that can hyperplantar flex. And it's your natural pooping dog position that make you a phenomenal swimmer. And so once I understood that, my job was to get people to move better. So my job was to create better joint stability, better posture, and then basic primal functions. I throw in some of the directed things like high speed running, quickness, change of direction, because I feel that's something that everybody needs, no matter who you are, whether you need it now or you're going to need it at some point in time when that dog is chasing you. And that's what my team on there is really designed for, is let's just make somebody a better athlete.
Cool.
And I'll make you squat toes forward.
Well, we make everybody squat toes forward, because that's how everybody should squat.
Why is there so much anger behind this? Like, there's significant anger. People get angry.
It's didn't Albert Einstein say, great minds will always meet violent opposition from lesser beings?
Ooh, lesser beings. That's
maybe
racist.
Maybe I had that lesser beings. Google that for me.
Keep talking.
But I think the way that people look at it is, they're looking at it purely, because I had a good talk with Greg Everett, who I count as a really excellent coach and a contemporary of mine, and one of the guys that has a really good sense of humor. But Greg talked about it being like, well, for Olympic lifting, where they need to be able to catch in that bottom position, getting the knees out of the way and opening the toes up opens up the hips and allows them to get under there, more efficiently. And I looking at it from, and we had a great talk, and he was like, this is a good efficient position for us in the pole and whatnot. And I talked about it from the idea of developing the squat as a primal movement pattern and developing something for change of direction and running. And he's like, well, you're looking at the movement pattern for an application, we're looking at it for a different one. Correct. So, and my thing is, I think everybody should pull them. Great spirits have always encountered violent opposition from mediocre minds. What did I say?
Lesser people.
Lesser minds.
Lesser people.
No,
I think you said lesser people.
I think lesser beings. I used the word beings.
Beings, yes.
Yeah, so great spirits have always encountered violent opposition from mediocre minds. The mediocre mind is incapable of understanding the man who refuses to bow blindly to conventional prejudices and chooses instead to express his opinions courageously. Fuck. Ruiz, not Einstein, and honestly.
Damn. I like it.
Fuck, that's a great quote.
But I think...
I just think people are rooted in it. And the problem becomes, at least for us, when people start driving their knees out to the point where they lift their big toe off the ground and they drive outside their toe box, you take away all your power. The only thing I could think of is, like, if you open your toes up and they drive their knees out, maybe they can still keep their big toe down.
But it's exactly what you alluded to earlier, is somewhere down the line in the microcosm of CrossFit was, hey, look at all these cool things that people are doing.
I think that came from Mark Ripto.
Well, I'm sure.
It's the idea.
Olympic lifting. I mean,
Olympic lifting, powerlifting. I mean, correct. Realistically, the only people that are talking about squatting toes forward is us.
Is us.
I mean, Kelly teaches it, but his deal is like drive the knees up to try to create internal hip torque. Whereas, we don't, you should drive your knees out, but never out past the toe box to where you can roll your big toe comes off the ground. So put your big toe on the ground, drive your knee out, and it's probably going to track right over your instep. And if it doesn't, you should probably widen your stance a little bit more.
But see, for me, the problem that I see is somewhere down the line, Olympic lifting has been very successful, and somebody said, wow, look at all the power they're producing, so let's put it into strength conditioning.
Sure,
let's
put I was in that program.
Let's put in powerlifting, let's put in blah, blah, blah. But nobody took into account what you just said, is they do that technique so that they could get deeper into the squat and catch.
Sure.
And somewhere down the line, somebody forgot to put that footnote in there when they took that program and said, back in the 60s, hey, look at these guys lifting, let's use this for my football team.
Yeah.
And without a emulsifying mind to sit there and say, okay, I like that's developing powerful quadruple extension, But we need to make a small tweak to it because most injuries are occurring on the eccentric portion of a squat catch, which is your plant foot change of direction.
Sure.
And if I'm driving my knees out or my toes out, and that becomes my new go-to habit, then that is going to set myself up.
Is when you turn your toes out, you can't get your glutes to fire.
Yep.
And so we get into all these people where they don't really develop the glute, and we know the glute is one of your big pushers for in the sprint and the run, and you look at change of direction. And, you know, that ability to push the hips back. And then, you know, we also look at it from the idea like, well, why are we squatting? Okay, well, if our basic bilateral hip hinge is our universal athletic position, and I want to challenge posture position through full range of motion and that universal athletic position, and I'm going to use external resistance, aka a barbell or whatever else we use to challenge posture and position, then I have to create that good universal athletic position and challenge it. And we know that that is a toes forward position. I have never seen any football player, and maybe I'm fucking wrong. I mean, when you guys go watch preseason, don't watch preseason, it's fucking terrible. Watch the regular season. Watch when a linebacker sets up, or you watch like a running back, when he's in his, what we call his stance, his universal athletic position, when he's ready to go, watch where his feet are. They point north and south. Not a single person is pointed out this way.
But you know, the problem is, training in a weight room with a bar on your back, the stressor and the load is
straight down,
but the inefficiency in the injury is caused when it's coming lateral.
Yeah.
And that's the shift in the mindset that people who are so opposed to keeping the toes forward and the knees forward are missing that. It's, yeah, I'm not going to get injured because I'm not squatting low enough. I'm going to get injured because I can't control lateral displacement of my knee.
Yeah.
And that's the part that they're missing is,
or they
keep
can't
that thing forward.
Decelerate. And then you look at like ACL.
Well, that's exactly what I'm saying.
Because they can't get their glute involved. And that was my big thing. I'm like, dude, you want to guarantee a torn ACL? I want you to run full speed and try to decelerate with a glute and a hamstring that's underdeveloped compared to your quad.
Yeah.
I'm like, dude, that's a dead giveaway. Or you watch guys go plant and the knee gets too far outside the foot. And what happens? The knee wobbles and they tear things. I mean, you know, like what were you saying earlier? It was with force plates, pounds per square inch.
Oh, there was a recent study that high-level sprinters were producing 7,000 pounds of pressure, force per square inch.
And then you look at how much pounds per square inch to break a bone or tear a ligament.
Absolutely.
And then you think about the elasticity of the muscles and the fact that these are, you know, shock absorbers, and you go through the whole deal. But you know, you start looking and things start, the idea becomes, if you're going to drive your car 200 miles an hour, which we do every day to work in piece of shit trucks, if you loosen your lug nuts, you might not have a problem today. You might not be tomorrow, as long as you're driving in a straight line. All of a sudden, we put you on a twisty road and you got to take some curves. Those things are going to shear off. You're going to lose your stud head. And all of a sudden, dude, you're going to have a fucking a catastrophe rollover. Same thing. I mean, if we're constantly doing a training program that looks like bilateral hip hinge and is basically always moving straight ahead, no change of direction, no transverse, no lateral movement, you just do here, everything's done in the doorway, then you know what? Then squatting with your toes out and doing all these different movements is fine. The minute you add change of direction, transverse plane, and you start forcing people to move through space and have to ask them to develop and solve complex problems, like I need to get over this, and then it becomes more and more problem.
So how do you sell athletes on the utmost importance of eccentric ability, your ability to handle eccentric strain? Because in essence, that is going to be the number one factor of whether somebody is injury resistant and increasing performance. Because we've learned, and this is the part that I struggled with early as a professional, was I'm spending so much time on injury prevention. Am I not getting enough performance work in my athletes? And one of the things that I found was, hell yeah, because my athletes not losing posture or positioning was a huge increase to performance versus somebody who either completely loses it or spends so much time and energy and mechanical strain on trying to recapture bad position, which, you know, for anybody who doesn't know, is almost impossible to do at high velocity.
Yeah.
So
Well, I mean, you know, when I trained at Athletes Performance with Verstegen, they would bring a guy in and they would literally have him do single leg bridges, trying to teach him to, like, you know, activate his core, which developed my hatred of the word core. But they would bring these guys in and have them do just what I call fuck aroundness for 6 weeks, trying to, like, get them to, like, activate. And I remember thinking, like, this guy was here 6 weeks, paid you thousands of dollars, and you never once fucking put him under a load. Wow. And I remember asking him about it, and they're like, well, he wasn't ready. And I was like, okay, so you didn't think he was ready to handle, like, a barbell or this? And they tried to convince me that Vert-Tec, like, the bands around the waist was as good as Olympic lifting, which at that point I was fucking out.
Oof.
But they were talking about, no, he wasn't ready. I'm like, this dude's going to training camp in 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Like, you don't think that, you know, if anything, getting him under a barbell or doing some basic barbell training or just some weights will help him develop at least a little bit of confidence? Fuck, you had him over there doing single leg bridges for 3 weeks, and now all of a sudden you're, or 6 weeks, and now you're going to have him go out and get slammed into by other 300-pound dudes?
Yeah.
I'm like, and they were like, well, I'm like, if you're waiting for perfection, you're going to be fucking waiting.
Forever.
And I was like, it's like the age-old thing, like having kids. Like, if you're waiting for perfection, fucking never happen.
It was funny. One of my first days in camp with the Bucks, Mitch, our tight end, I remember we were doing some balance stuff, and he was like, Raph, I appreciate this, but in the end of the day, I need to feel like I have some lead in my ass. Yeah. He goes, I got to battle, you know, Cheaty and Warren Sapp every day, you know, for the rest of this camp. He goes, I got to feel like, and it taught me, because I was young and I was enthusiastic about, you know, let's do all this functional stuff and take your shoes off and here, put this blindfold on and these earplugs and, you know, I'm going to sing Kumbaya to you while you do single leg pops.
Yeah.
And he was like, oh, I think it's going to work, you know, but in the end, I've got to have a little lead in my ass.
You got to put some heavy bar in your hand and you got to do some shit. So, Luke, you got anything else?
Yeah, one quick question.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, sure, sir. Just asking a little bit about form collar.
Oh,
and right. Where we're at with development on that, and like, in terms of they come into the program. And
yeah, the where it all started was we did a cycle of Field Strong, and I needed a way to test people, so we had this big testing cycle. And I looked at the numbers, and I had this idea that I was going to develop all these tests. We're going to vertical jump, we're going to squat, and there's going to be like some beautiful mind correlation. And there was zero thread. I couldn't see a common thread in all of these numbers. Literally, I had like all of these in a spreadsheet. We're looking at them, and I'm like,
Nothing.
And I like kind of lost it a little bit, and I like started calling different people. I think I even called you. And I remember I called Louis Simmons, and I asked Louis, and he was like, well, did you see, you know, how are they moving? Did you watch the videos? And I was like, well, I'm going to do that next. So I went and I started watching all the YouTube videos, and people posted their results and everything. And all of a sudden, the one common thread was everybody was really slow. And I like had this weird epiphany that like, train slow, train fast, be fast. So we needed to add something in for some speed. And so we started looking at, you know, kind of doing some velocity-based training. And I went back and instantly remembered what we'd done with Zangus was, you know, the idea of compensatory acceleration, the idea from my head frat, or the principle, which I call, we call cat, and Luke likes to call cat shit, is the idea that as mechanical advantage increases, you need to keep accelerating the weight or the implement. And so I went back and I looked at some percentages and we ended up getting a tendo, and I went back and looked at a lot of velocity-based training and started putting in really, okay, I want you to, you know, hit this percentage based off of this 5RM, and I want you to do X amount of reps. And we went back and looked at Prolin's table. And so we needed a way to, we were using a tendo, so we knew how fast people were doing. So people started videoing their deal, and they would send it to us and ask us, was that fast enough? And I'm like, and you know, we had watched the tendo enough to know whether or not somebody was, you know, moving as fast as they could or not. And we had tested, you know, Luke and all of us and different girls and different people. And we knew that, you know, certain people could move much faster than others, which only makes sense based off of, you know, muscle fiber type and training history. And we needed a way to test people. And just about that time, a young kid who's was a little fed up, I think, with his current job came in, and he had been recommended to us, and he wanted to develop a collar that counted reps.
Wow.
And I was like, fuck that. We don't need that. We don't need to count reps.
Yeah.
We need a collar that does all this stuff. So we showed him the tendo. We told him what we wanted, and he would come back periodically, and he ended up developing the form collar, and that was Scott.
That's awesome.
And it was pretty amazing. I mean, the the hardware was really done because of the accelerometer based on the iPhone, and then it was about going back and developing the app, developing a really jiggy interface where you could use your phone and Bluetooth and develop the collars. And, you know, we started measuring it, but what we're realizing now is, as you get these numbers, what do they mean, and how do they help me to train more efficiently, and how do they maximize my goals?
Yeah, what do you do with that number?
So I mean, that's what I've really been going back on, is really writing a set of parameters, and then realizing that, and this is a really hard thing, is the more advanced you are, and you know this, right? The more advanced you are, the more heightened and more, I guess you could say, wired up your central nervous system is. So the more advanced an athlete, the more efficient the nervous system, so they should be able to generate more force, right? Because, you know, you look at inter and intramuscular coordination, now all of a sudden, you know, the muscles working within working together, now it's working in cohesion with all the other muscles. And so a more advanced athlete should theoretically be able to move at a higher velocity than an untrained athlete. So now how do we use velocity-based training for beginners? Because unfortunately, or fortunately, most of the people that come to us are still in their beginner stage. And when I say beginner, it's not a insult, it's really that amateur that could last up to a couple, you know, 4 or 5 years. I counted myself as a beginner for years. And it wasn't until I reached intermediate, which was probably in college, that, you know, I didn't get to advanced until I was 6 or 7 years down the road. And at each point in the training had to be representative of where I was in my journey. And we talk about the journey of a lifter, the journey of an athlete, or really the life cycle of training. And how do we offer velocity-based training? And how do we put numbers and ideas and quantify to help people get better? But it has to match where they are in the journey. Because if you look at like Prilipin's table, where they looked at volume and percentage and all these different things, they were testing higher level Olympic lifters.
Yeah.
So then, well,
training in a bubble.
Yeah, training in a bubble in the Eastern Bloc country where they were probably using performance enhancing. Right, so you have these numbers, and then, you know, but here's the thing, nobody ever looks and thinks I'm a beginner. I gotta go to the most advanced shit, because that's obviously the hardest, that's what I need, but it's not what you need. So, like, that's the thing, and when I talked to Scott about, you know, as we sat down and developed this, I can tell you what the advanced athlete's gonna do. I can tell you what the intermediate athlete's gonna do. I can't tell you what the beginner's gonna do, because we don't have the numbers.
Yeah. You don't have enough proficiency at the movement even.
Yeah, to be able to do it. Because, I mean, what's the limiting factor? Is it technique? Is it just opportunity? Is it understanding? Is it, you know, like they might still just trying to find themselves.
Oh, yeah.
You know? I mean, it's like, how are you supposed to, somebody asked me, somebody says, hey, tell me all about yourself. I don't even know myself. How the hell can I tell you about it? I'm still trying to figure out. Somebody's like, God, tell me about yourself. I'm like, I don't even know who I am yet. I'm still waiting for that dare to be great situation. So I think where we are with it is being able to really put a stake in the ground and say, all right, this is how I need you to train, and this is what the information. And I say the only way we're going to find it is by getting more collars in people's hands. And, you know, that's something that we really talked to Scott about, is the more people get it, the more information we get, it almost gets all plugged into a database, and we can start looking at it, and, you know, how do we, and we really talked about that user journey, is like, who are you? Mm-hmm. How long have you been training? What, you know, and we almost need like a, and Scott, we've talked about this, is that when you sign up, there has to be a set of parameters that you answer these questions that helps us not only understand who you are on the profile, but lets us get all this information in real time. So what the collars allowed us to do is to just get, I would love a billion data points that Luke can plug into something, and all of a sudden we can see, like, okay, people training, you know, 0 to 1 years, you know, based off of their body weight, 1RM, or getting here, and, you know, this program here, we know linear progression works for beginners because it tricks their nervous system. By just adding a little bit more to what they do each day, we can keep pressing, but then you get to a point where it ends. And then you have to look at it, like, all right, at that point, I got to do some undulating periodization, and I got to do this, and you got to do this, and I got to be a, you know, advanced athlete that's going to periodize different things through the years. And, like, it just, so where we are is we are at the point of getting the collars out into people's hands and sitting down and developing a really comprehensive book, an ebook, or some manual that people can look at and be like, fuck, this has got some really good numbers, this is some stuff. This is who I am. Are you a beginner, intermediate, advanced, and then here's how you fit into it.
But I think in the world where we're so metric crazy, the velocity specific movement and having that number is the one thing that you can't have enough of.
Yeah.
Every other metric you can finagle, you can skew, you can any numbers and averages. I mean, there's no telling. Anybody can justify anything with numbers, but velocity-based training is you either moving the bar fast or you're not moving the bar fast.
Yeah.
You know, it was interesting. A statistician once asked me, he said, "What if I was going to tell you to, we're going to send you out of space to this planet, and I was going to tell you that the average temperature is 50 degrees.
Would you go?
Well,
you wouldn't go.
The average person, and yeah, I say, with a jacket.
Still wouldn't go.
With a couple layers. And a chinchilla, a live one.
Dude, sorry, I don't mean to get out there. Raph would come visit me in Philly, and he would always come at the end of the year, and like I would see him, he would have like this coat on, and it would be like what was the guy in South Park with this, like, Kenny. He would look like Kenny. I'd be like, is that Raphael up there? And like, what the fuck coat is that? It'd be like my parents would bring him this, like, I swear to God, it was like an Arctic dive coat. My dad, like, went scuba diving in, like, somewhere really cold, and he bought this jacket that was, like, this full-length, like, waterproof, like, trench coat that had all this, like, fleece lining. It was, like, this dive coat for, like, sub-Arctic deal. And I look over, and Raph's over there. I'm like, this fucking guy. We're out there in shirt sleeves, and Raph's like, it's so cold, I can't feel my feet. So, Raph's a warm-blooded person.
I am. I'm a jungle folk. But it was interesting because a statistician gave me this very good example, and he said, if I told you that the average temperature on this planet was 50 degrees, would you go? And I said, yeah, I could tolerate 50. He goes, but the missing metric is that at night it's zero, and then during the day it's 100. And I sat there and I was like, you know what? Without that information, the metric means nothing. It's so easy to skew, and, you know, we talk about this all the time where everything is about, you know, one-upmanship with all of these numbers that, you know, how much do you squat, how much do you bench, blah, 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 which I think some form of competitive nature is great.
Yeah, but there's no standardization.
But if you're going to get into performance training, you have to change that paradigm. You have to look at it in a completely different nature.
I mean, you have to start measuring apples to apples, not apples to oranges. My squat versus your squat, my bench versus your bench, and this, and you know how I did it. So,
like, I don't know as far as the experience that you guys have, but I remember I taught a seminar at a very well-known school, and I happened to be there all week. And at the end of the week, the staff said, you know, tomorrow is testing day, get your sweatshirts out. And I was like, and this was a summer seminar, and I was like, I just don't understand. And so the next day, I just kind of brush it off, and I show up regular, and I'm just here to observe testing day. And sure enough, the whole staff has their sweatshirts on. And I'm like, what is going on? And the inside joke was, because when they max, they don't want to see the strain of their forearms because they're helping the athletes beat their maxes.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, genius, sweatshirt day. Fuck. And I go, metrics. I go, we're so addicted to metrics that we're willing to do that just for the sake of metrics.
Where is the only metric that matters?
Speed.
Is
speed of movement.
Speed of movement. And wins and losses.
Boom.
So speed kills. So.
Tex, you have anything?
I think we got everything. So thank you very much for joining us on Talk to Me Johnnie on the Long Road with Mr. Raphael Ruiz. And until we see each other again, later.